This is Guardian Radio, your station for up-to-the-minute news, intelligent, interactive, and engaging conversation. 96.9 FM. The views and opinions of the hosts and guests are their own and do not necessarily reflect the position of the management and staff of Guardian Network.
Good morning. The FNM deputy questioned by police. More on that bizarre death involving a landlord and his son. And deepening ties with Botswana, the Bahamas, and Botswana signing an MOU on mutual development. It's all straight ahead this morning. I'm Dwight Strawn, and this is Morning Blend.
Wake up. Wake up, it's a new day. It's the start of the start of a new way.
Good morning again, Bahamas. It is Friday, September 15th, 2023. This is Morning Blend on Guardian Radio 96.9. Again, I'm Dwight Strawn. In a moment, Stephen Hanna will be joining us. Also this morning in Morning Blend Business, we are getting an update on Sand Dollar, how the rollout is going. Central Bank will be joining us this morning. That's all straight ahead. But first, it's time for the overnight, the latest breaking news from while you were sleeping, and the top national and international headlines this morning. In the overnight, FNM Deputy Leader Shannon Cartwright questioned by police over the weekend in relation to their investigation into contracts issued by the Bahamas Public Parks and Beaches Authority. Cartwright served as executive chairman of the authority during the Minutes administration. He was at the state reception for the president of Botswana on Wednesday night, but since coming to office in 2021, the Davis administration has raised alarm over contracts issued by the authority. Last year, chairman of the Bahamas Public Parks and Public Beaches Authority, Mikel Bonaby, claimed there appeared to be no checks and balances in place regarding the issuance of contracts. But Cartwright has on multiple occasions defended his tenure in the House of Assembly last year. He said that he denied and rejected any suggestions or accusations that he participated in any willful wrongdoing or knew of any wrongdoing. Police have yet to comment publicly on the investigation. Hailing the state visit of President of Botswana, Motsoetsi Masisi, as a success, Prime Minister Philip Brave Davis saying that a memorandum of understanding was signed between the two countries to foster economic development and ensure mutual progress. Davis saying during a joint press conference yesterday that the administration is actively strengthening its foreign policy, and the visit of the President of Botswana stands as clear evidence of the commitment. He said the engagements highlight the dedication to deepening existing ties and exploring new partnerships. Prime Minister has on many occasions defended his frequent travels across the globe since his election. Masisi noted that during a bilateral meeting last year, Davis invited him to the Bahamas. A man who's serving a 40-year sentence for murder will learn his fate concerning a second murder conviction next month. 32-year-old Mark McKenzie will be sentenced on October 12th for the murder of Carlos Adderley Jr. McKenzie appeared before Justice Franklin Williams, KC, yesterday for a sentencing hearing. A probation officer testified that McKenzie denied killing Adderley, whom he described as a childhood friend. McKenzie maintained his innocence and said that he had no reason to kill Adderley. Adderley was on a basketball court near a church in Blue Hills Estates when a gunman, identified as McKenzie by an anonymous witness, shot him multiple times on January 17, 2017. Adderley's mother said she forgave McKenzie, but she said she wanted justice. Adderley was killed months before he was scheduled to graduate from the University of the Bahamas with a degree in mechanical engineering. McKenzie, who has been using drugs since he was 8 years old, was expelled from Bahamas Academy for drug use. McKenzie's the father of an 11-year-old girl, and the mother of their child described him as a, quote, real man and a good father. The man accused of killing Omar Davis Jr. and discarding his body has been denied bail. 21-year-old Normand Toussaint of Orchid Lane is accused of killing his 20-year-old friend at his New Providence home. After the murder, Toussaint allegedly put Davis's body in bags, which he put in the trunk of Davis's car. The vehicle was abandoned in bushes near the Caribbean liquor store on East Avenue, where Toussaint worked. Davis's family reported him missing after he failed to return home. His decomposing body was found in the car on August 16, 2022. Toussaint, who does not have Bahamian citizenship, represented himself at his bail hearing before Justice Gregory Hilton. And a 9-member jury selected to hear the attempted murder and attempted armed robbery case of Leonardo Wright. Prosecutors allege that Wright shot Alexander Dean during an attempted holdup of Dean's building supply, Parkgate Road. The incident allegedly took place September 5th, 2009. Wright, who's on bail, has been denied the charges at his trial before Justice Gregory Hilton. Wright was initially represented by public defender Dorsey McPhee. However, Wright said he wanted a privately retained lawyer. The matter was adjourned to Monday for Wright to get counsel. Overseas, Libyan authorities sealing off an inundated city today to allow search teams to dig through the mud and hollowed out buildings for 10,000 people missing and feared dead after the official toll from flooding soared past 11,000 dead. Authorities warning that disease and explosives shifted by the water could take yet more lives. Two dams collapsed in exceptionally heavy rains from Mediterranean storm Daniel early Monday, sending a wall of water several meters high gushing down a valley that cuts through the city of Derna. The unusual flooding and Libya's political chaos contributed to the enormous toll. The oil-rich state has been split since 2014 between rival governments in the east and west, backed by various militia forces and international patrons. The disaster has brought rare unity, though, as government agencies across the country rush to help the affected areas. But relief efforts have been slowed by the destruction after several bridges that connect the city were destroyed. Heaps of twisted metal and flooded cars littered Derna's streets, which are caked in a tan mud. Teams have buried bodies in mass graves outside the city and in nearby towns. But officials worry that thousands of bodies are still hidden in the muck or floating in the sea where divers were sent to search. And the Dominican Republic's president announcing that he will close all borders with neighboring Haiti starting today in a dispute over a canal on the Haitian side that would use water from a river along their frontier. President Luis Abinader saying that air, sea, and land borders would close at 6 a.m. local time today and would remain shuttered until necessary, signaling that last-minute talks between the countries have failed to head off the closure. It's a rare move for the Dominican Republic and could hit economies in both countries, but will most likely affect Haiti the most. The closure is a response to the excavation of a canal by a farming group on the Haitian side that targets waters on the Massacre River, which runs along the border shared by the two countries on the island of Hispaniola. The International Crisis Group said the work on the canal had been suspended since the July 2021 assassination of President Jovenel Moise, and it resumed based on the inaction of the Haitian government. quote, which has failed to respond to the problems created by the drought in the agricultural areas of the Marabaru Plain. The organization has seen no evidence, it says, that suggests that there are any major politicians or powerful business people behind it, as the Dominican government has claimed. In sports, it's happened again. Bahamian professional baseball player with Miami Marlins, Jazz Rado Jazz Chisholm Jr., out again, this time with knee discomfort. This happened in the Marlins 2-0 win over the Milwaukee Brewers in Wisconsin, Milwaukee, on Wednesday. Chisholm was out of the lineup on Thursday, and the Marlins fell to National League Central Division leaders, the Brewers, 4-2, dropped the series 3-1. According to reports, Chisholm tweaked his right knee while trying to beat out a throw to first after grounding into a double play in the top of the fourth inning. He told reporters afterwards that it wasn't anything serious and was available to come off the bench on Thursday but never entered the game. Famed professional American football player Michael Strawn is no longer with the team that drafted him into the NFL, the Indianapolis Colts. He was signed to the Carolina Panthers practice squad on Wednesday, though. Strawn was released from the Colts practice squad on Tuesday, along with running back Jason Huntley and tight end Johnny Lumpkin. Strawn was picked in the 7th round of the NFL draft in 2021. Grand Bahama native reunites with his former coach Frank Reich, though, who drafted him. He joins the Panthers team that has an 0-1 win-loss record so far this early season. And more from the NFL Thursday night football action kicking off week 2. Jalen Hurts forcing a throw into double coverage, one of his worst passes in years, and was picked off by A.J. Brown. He, of the nearly 1,500 yards receiving a year ago, threw a tantrum on the sidelines when the ball didn't come his way. And in the Eagles' home opener, fans booed the NFC champions in the first half when a string of offensive plays went nowhere. But yet, Philadelphia remains 2-0. The Eagles already knew they'd be tested as they try to return to the Super Bowl, and they know it won't be easy. They beat the Minnesota Vikings 34-28 last night. Hurts, the MVP runner-up, shook off a sluggish passing performance in the first half and woke up the crowd when he connected with Smith for the scoring strike in the third quarter that made it at that time 27-7 in a game that went back and forth. But again, beating the Vikings 34-28, the Eagles still 2-0 so far. That's sports, and that's the overnight. Time for your first look at weather. Your first look at weather brought to you by Nescafe Coffee. We've got moderate swells along eastern coastlines. That's going to continue as Hurricane Lee gradually moves away from our area. A weak surface ridge of high pressure will continue to support high temperatures and light to gentle winds across the islands, while a surface trough extending from Hurricane Lee will produce unsettled weather over the southeast Bahamas and portions of the central islands. So, again, the hazardous marine conditions will continue as Lee moves away from the area. The conditions will be in the form of life-threatening surf and rip currents due to significant swells generated by Lee. And everybody's being advised to refrain from swimming. Get out of the water, especially along Atlantic coastlines. And it's going to be another hot day, as we said, so residents are being advised to remain hydrated and limit outdoor sun exposure. So for today, for all areas, the forecast calls for partly sunny conditions with a chance of a few isolated showers or thunderstorms, becoming fair and warm with a few passing showers tonight. It's Small craft operators are advised to remain in port. Winds north to northeast at 10 knots or less, falling light and variable at times. Seas 3 to 5 feet near shore, but up to 10 feet along Atlantic exposures in northeasterly swells. Temperatures today getting up to around 92 Fahrenheit, 33 Celsius, but the heat index back up into the triple digits. You've been feeling it all week, though. Around 100 degrees, that's how hot it's going to feel. 100 Fahrenheit, 38 Celsius. Overnight lows tonight getting down to a warm 80 Fahrenheit, 27 Celsius. That's your first look at weather this morning. You'll have your extended outlook and a look at the tropics coming up after traffic in just a bit. This first look at weather brought to you by Nescafe Coffee. Elevate your coffee experience with Nescafe Gold. Let's take a break. When we come back, though, we're discussing today's top stories right here on Morning Blend on Guardian Radio 96.9, your home for fresh news and smart talk all day.
It's back to school season again. Send your kids off with everything they need, from books, uniforms, to school supplies, all with a Fidelity personal loan. Apply today for a chance to win amazing back to school prizes. Call 356-7764.
Doctors Hospital has reimagined primary care. We have invested to improve our health system, ensuring that accessible, affordable, world-class clinical care is closer to you. We understand that your relationship with a primary care provider shapes the foundation of your overall health. Our new modern primary care facilities are where critical diagnoses and true personalized treatment begins. With locations across New Providence, Grand Bahama, and Exuma, we invite you to experience the Doctors Hospital difference. Book your next appointment at clinics.doctorshosp.com.
Want to know more about divorce, personal injury, wills, company formation, conveyances, and mortgages? Then sign up for Hulsbury Chambers' 16th Annual Free Legal Clinic, Saturday, September 23rd, 2023, Village Road North. Call 393-4551 to reserve your spot today. Space is limited. Lawyers available from 9 a.m. to 3 p.m. Consultations only. This is a community service event sponsored by Hulsbury Chambers. Screws and Fasteners World, Balfour Avenue and Palm Beach Street, has those hard-to-find fasteners for you right now. You can find stainless steel regular hex, carriage bolts, galvanized bolts, threaded rods, nails, self-tap screws, sex bolts, anchor bolts, turnbuckles, masonry tools, hand tools, and weed whacker strings. Check out the rope selection and car body fasteners, too. Special orders are welcome. It's your number one fastener store. Screws and Fasteners World, Balfour Avenue and Palm Beach Streets. Call 326-1976.
Earning zero interest on your savings at the bank? With as little as $100, you can start earning interest on your money while you're sleeping, eating, or standing in line at the bank with the CFAL Savings Express Plan. Ready to invest? Start by putting $1,000 into our mutual funds and earn interest there too. Because at CFAL, your interest is our interest. Visit CFAL.com to start now. CFAL, growing wealth for future generations of Bahamians.
Wherever you're headed, the Custom Computers Know-How team is standing by to help guide you in the East and the West. We now have two convenient locations on Patton Street in Palmdale and our newest store in the Caves Village Shopping Plaza through the Blake Road entrance. Discover the latest products by top international brands and the knowledge you need to unleash tomorrow's technology today. Drop by Custom Computers out east or out west. We're open Saturdays from 10 till 4.
The signs are clear. It's time to pay less for your current mortgage by switching to Scotiabank. Enjoy lower interest rates and no payments up to 2 months when you switch to Scotiabank today. Plus, we'll even pay your switch costs. It's that easy. Ready to switch to Scotiabank? Call us today at 242-356-1697 or visit bs.scotiabank.com to switch your mortgage to become mortgage-free faster.
This is Guardian Radio 96.9 FM. Fresh news, smart talk, all day.
wake up, it's a new day. Wake up, it's a new day. It's the start of the start of a new way.
You know that this
is the start of the end of the old way. Wake up.
Welcome back to Morning Blend here on Guardian Radio 96.9. We are streaming live on GuardianTalkRadio.com and on the Guardian Radio app for smart devices. We're also on your televisions on Cable Bahamas Channel 969 and BTC Flow Channel 612. You can tweet us at MorningBlend969 or Facebook.com/MorningBlend969. Text us on the Guardian Radio text line powered by BTC 422-4796. Standard text rate supply. Once again, I'm Dwight Strawn. Joining me now, Stephen Hanna. Stephen Hanna, good morning.
Hey.
Okay, speaking to the mic, sir.
Yeah.
Barely. Great to have you with us on a Friday morning, as always.
Yeah.
Okay, we appreciate the enthusiasm. It's wonderful. Coming up this morning, in business, we're going to be talking with the central bank, the sand dollar. We'll get an update on how that's going. And find out some details about what the future holds. That's coming up. But right now, let's talk about what else is in the news. And in the news, folks are still trying to understand this bizarre story from a few days ago, the death of a man and his son, apparently, and what exactly went down. Words like bizarre been used, unusual, it's certainly more than unusual. But as we try to put the pieces together, the police are trying as well, get a little more insight, I think, in this report from our Jared Higgs.
The man who died along with his toddler son under bizarre circumstances earlier this week was trying to be more involved in his other son's life before his death, according to his estranged wife. 42-year-old Jermaine Miller and his 22-month-old Anwar Miller died under unusual circumstances early Tuesday morning after the 42-year-old allegedly attacked his tenants in the middle of the night at an Airbnb on Family Street off Soldier Road. 27-year-old Shaniqua Dorval was married to Miller, and they had a 6-year-old son together. Anwar is Miller's son with another woman. Dorval said Miller was spending more time with their son, and he had expressed gratitude to her for allowing them to spend more time together. In the days leading up to the tragic incident, Miller had both his sons with him, according to Dorval. She said their 6-year-old son was in Miller's care when the incident unfolded, and she saw him hours before the tragedy.
And my son, which is his son too, they came by my work and he came and he picked up clothes. And he was in a rush and he was like, you won't tell your mommy, tell your mommy you gone, tell your mommy you love her. And my son was like, love you, mommy, I gone. And they gone. But when he went to me and pull up by my work, he was like, okay, he didn't look like anyone was like going through anything.
But hours later, a shocking and bizarre incident would unfold. According to Chief Superintendent Michael Johnson, officers responded to reports that two men were fighting on Family Street off Soldier Road around 12:30 a.m. When officers arrived, a man told them that he was being attacked by his landlord, according to Johnson. By the end of the encounter, Miller and his 22-month-old son were dead. The toddler didn't have any visible wounds. However, there was some discoloration of the skin. Johnson said autopsies would need to be performed to determine the exact causes of death.
It could have been my son, too. It could have been my son, you know, I mean, thank God. But it's so sad that the baby, I was trying to figure why the baby, like, why would he take his son? Why would he take the baby? This was my question. Why take the baby? And he didn't take all two of his children together with him. Like, what was going on? Why the baby?
Dorval described Miller, a taxi driver, as a provider and a hustler.
A go-getter. He was a nice person, a person like to stay to himself. He don't mix. And a person always speaking of goals. He had ambition.
She said Miller was an excellent landlord before the shocking attack.
He was like, I could say the best landlord anybody would have won a house. You can camp, you could come to him today and call him and say, Jermaine, I can be late on rent and it's like no problem. As long as you straight up and you honest and you tell him when will you be able to have the funds, he have no problem. He's a person to look out, I must say. He probably was trying like to probably find someone to talk to and he didn't know like who to talk to, and I just don't know, like, I was lost, but I was saying if he needed someone to talk to, like, he gonna come to me and he gonna talk to me. I really didn't know, like, if he was going through anything, but he didn't, seems like he was going through anything, but of what happened, when I heard of what happened, I felt as though, like, he was going through something.
Bahamas Power and...
Why? I don't know if that makes it any... No, more comprehensible about what's going on there.
I think it's yeah. going to be clearer.
So, but that's what we're hearing. I guess a character reference of the individual involved here. But boy, yeah, it's a real tragedy. So we will see. We will see. Hopefully, the police are getting closer and trying to understand what exactly happened. But just truly bizarre. So there's a lot of interesting court stories as well. This got a lot of attention last year.
Which one of them?
Yeah, all of them. Quite a lot going on. But so you remember this story, Arteza Davis writing about it. The brutal death of a young college student who was cut up and chopped up and put in a bag and into a trunk. So the man accused of killing Omar Davis Jr. and discarding his body was denied bail yesterday. A 21-year-old Norman Toussaint of Orchid Lane is accused of killing his 20-year-old friend at his New Providence home. After the murder, Toussaint allegedly put Davis's body in bags, which he put in the trunk of Davis's car. The vehicle was abandoned in bushes near the Caribbean liquor store on East Avenue where Toussaint worked. Davis's family reported him missing after he failed to return home. His decomposing body was found in the car on August 16, 2022. Toussaint, who does not have Bahamian citizenship, represented himself at his bail hearing before Justice Gregory Hilton. Boy. This story, a 9-member jury yesterday selected to hear the attempted murder and attempted armed robbery case of Leonardo Wright. Prosecutors allege that Wright shot Alexander Dean during an attempted holdup at Dean's Building Supply, Parkgate Road. The incident happened, allegedly, September 5th, 2009.
Not 19, 2009.
Is it a misprint, you think? 2009?
I'm just glad that everybody involved with the case is still alive.
Mm.
Because how do you think?
Do we know? I don't know if we know. Well, they just selected a jury. You might find out.
So then the accused must still be alive.
Well, just that. But anybody else?
I think they would have mentioned if.
Not yet. You'll find out. But 2009 is a long time ago. And this is crazy. What is the reason? Why now? Just coming up to this. This is... Wright, who is on bail, of course, will, has denied the charges at his trial before Justice Gregory Hilton. Wright was initially represented by public defender Dorsey McPhee, however, Wright said he wanted a privately retained lawyer. The matter has been adjourned to Monday for Wright to get counsel. 2009.
15 years, right?
Long before Guardian Radio was even a thought, I suspect.
I wouldn't think. I mean, it probably was a thought.
Maybe. But it wasn't anywhere near.
It was in place.
A thing.
Right.
Good Lord. Okay. And a man who's serving a 40-year sentence for murder will learn his fate concerning a second murder conviction next month. 32-year-old Mark McKenzie will be sentenced on October 12th for the murder of Carlos Adderley Jr. McKenzie appeared before Justice Franklin Williams Casey yesterday for a sentencing hearing. A probation officer testified that McKenzie denied killing Adderley, whom he described as a childhood friend. McKenzie has maintained his innocence and said that he had no reason to kill Adderley. Adderley was on a basketball court near a church in Blue Hills Estates when a gunman identified as McKenzie by an anonymous witness shot him multiple times on January 17, 2017. Adderley's mother said she forgave McKenzie, but said she wanted justice. Adderley was killed before he was scheduled to graduate from the University of the Bahamas with a degree in mechanical engineering. Now, McKenzie, who has been using drugs since he was 8 years old.
Well,
character reference, you know, was expelled from Bahamas Academy for drug use.
What it,
the court heard that in testimony.
I got that, but I mean, it's like, so,
well, see,
does that lend
those
to
those things? It comes back to haunt you.
No, but
so right, before you decide to pick up that whatever, just remember, yeah, boy, McKenzie is the father of an 11-year-old girl, despite all of that, and the mother of their child described him as a quote real man and a quote good father. He reportedly has a history of firearms convictions, though, I don't know why reportedly, that span a period of 17 years.
Because are they convictions? Maybe are they not convictions?
It's just rumors. McKenzie is serving a 40-year sentence for the March 2017 murder of Leslie Green in Yellow Elder. Well, okay, so, I mean, prosecutors have suggested a sentence in the range of 40 to 50 years for the second murder. Now, if they do convict him and they talk nonsense, I don't know. I'm just saying. This is what irritates people to talk about concurrent. What's the point?
Well, regardless, right now he's not going to get out of jail until the 70s.
Mm-hmm.
So I would imagine they're going to say concurrent.
Yeah. Well, in other places, they don't.
I mean, also.
I mean, it just gives the impression that you're serious.
I understand what you're saying. You know what? And once again.
Again, we don't know. Yeah.
Well, you don't know what.
Well, he's already been convicted. Yeah, he's been convicted.
What are you talking about?
Right. But again.
This is the one time we could actually talk about it.
Sure.
Right? My thing
but
is.
Show that you're serious. Why would you do that? It's a life. It's serious.
I hold the position. All right? I do not prescribe to capital punishment, but logically speaking, it would make more sense. Like, there should be a point system. If you hit 100 years, then we just might as well kill you. I mean, the state might as well kill you, because it doesn't make sense.
Well, you just live there for the rest of your life.
No, to what end? What is the purpose of it? It doesn't help. It's not going to help you. It's not going to bring the person back. It doesn't help the family. I've seen things in international news where they're like, if somebody kills someone, the murderer is responsible for the child's welfare until the child is 18. Mm-hmm. We don't have laws like that.
Mm.
So what is the point of keeping this person alive?
So you,
I don't
you
see it. But
make
I,
them work it off in prison?
Not work it off. You are now responsible for making sure that that family is taken care of. Oh. Not work it off. The same way, so for example, if somebody said, okay, if I had three children and a wife, and somebody murders me, whoever murdered me, the court isn't just going to put them in jail and then charge the public $16,000 a year to keep them alive. That person is going to have to amass the value that I would have produced in my lifetime.
Now, how would you do this?
Let them work or
where?
Do something.
Where?
there's a lot of work that needs to be done.
No, what are you saying? Should they be allowed to live out in
the community? No. I'm not saying that. I'm saying it doesn't make sense. So you're
saying the same thing I'm saying. In prison, you work.
Yeah. I mean, I just phrased, you're right. Okay. I mean, I phrased it differently.
Work it off.
Right. Work it off sounds like at the end, when the child reach 18,
No. But I mean, you work in prison until you're at the end of your days.
Yes, continually, and you're constantly paying off.
And that money goes back to the community, to the victims.
Well, yes, to the community to restore whatever, to help restore. But other than that, we're wasting time because it's like you just said, we're going to take this person out of the community. So now there's a vacuum where they would be, right? And some of these people are leaving children behind. Who's going to pay that? Make sure that child makes it through life. Mm-hmm. Make sure that child has a college education or has books and all this. Where is that happening? So, like, unless that is a part of the plan, then cheaper you just kill the person.
Yeah.
Right? And I mean that cheaper economically and cheaper socially and cheaper psychologically. It is just cheaper for us to just start hanging people once again if we're not going to actually fix the laws.
Or we could do what you suggested. I think that's
a great
idea.
No, I would prefer to do what I'm suggesting. I'm saying, if we're not going to do that, that as a person who doesn't believe in capital punishment,
I get you.
I would sign a petition for capital punishment.
So why don't we do that? I mean, I think
because I'm not a judge or a lawyer.
No, I mean, no, it's lawmakers to make it so that you have to pay for your crimes.
Yes,
right.
Literally.
Not just by spending time in prison, taking up space.
Right.
But you are going to make sure that family is taken care of.
Right. And the thing is, we know that there are persons who go to prison who have skills, right? We know that a person, when you go to prison, a four-year degree is 4 years. These people go into prison for the term of a doctorate degree. You're telling me that there's no way that they could contribute to society from where they are? That's ridiculous. So, make up your mind. What is it? And I hear it all the time where people love punitive justice is the term. But people just want to see somebody else get punched in the head. And that doesn't move society forward.
No.
If all we keep on doing is, this person punched me, so I'm going to punch them back. This person punched you, you have a broken eye socket. Who's going to pay for that? If your sight is damaged for the rest of your life, who's going to pay for that? That's what we need. We need restorative justice.
Yes. And we've heard the term many times before. They know what it is, but yet we are still here.
And then somebody got to pay for all the psychological and the therapy and all this different
and
stuff.
You know, that never happens.
Right.
Clearly.
But that needs to be all that needs to be wrapped up in this case.
Absolutely.
Saying, this is what happened. This is what the repercussion is, and this is how we're going to pay for it.
Totally agree. All right, let's get your views on it, folks. All the things we've talked about so far, these unusual cases, and a matter going back to 2009. And concurrent sentencing, yes. 323-6232. 325-4316. 325-4259. Call us toll-free, 242-300-5720. Tweet us, Facebook us, text us, 422-4796. Okay. People texting us with their wild theories on stuff. Okay, we won't read that. This person says here, still can't read that one. Based on how that young man was killed and discarded, I knew a Bahamian didn't do that murder. Okay, all right. That's not a regular thing for Bahamians to chop people up. Sure. Okay.
It's not the 80s anymore, right?
Right. Well, that was one or two people in the 80s.
It's not the 2000s, because now that I think about it,
Once a decade, but not regularly. So, okay. I get you, Texas.
That was our one.
Thank you for that. We just like to shoot you. Right. We shoot you and stab you.
Yeah, because
That's how we kill you.
Crimes of ignorance, because you're detached
bricks
from the
bricks too, border. Right?
Yeah,
bricks and rocks.
And run over people.
Yes, we've that's Bahamian.
We've seen that several times in the past years, where people have attempted to run over people with a car.
Yes,
people light people on fire.
Just recently,
women apparently believe that women only kill people or injure people with acid.
Acid.
And
that's why a Bahamian did it.
Right. So, and then men emulate themselves. That is to light yourself on fire. Right?
You mean afterward, the murder-suicide thing? As you're talking about?
I mean, just in general. I'm just saying all the wild.
Not too common. That's not too common.
I can think of two incidents.
That's two out of 100-something years. In recent time. Come on now. But yes, you're right, Texter. Bahamas will drop you up. Okay. Like, this person says here, concurrent sentencing is not unique to the Bahamas. I didn't say that it was. I'm just saying that it says a lot.
He's saying he's sick and tired.
I actually am. I think you and they keep taking off time for this, the time that you served, the time that you were in the police custody, and this. And you're like, okay.
I mean, listen, that's what I mean. You could take off a year from my 40-year sentence. That doesn't change anything if you're in your 30s.
When was the last time you heard of a 40-year sentence?
I mean, right? Besides today,
because right.
It must have been horrific. Like,
they can't count that high. No. So wow, but yeah, concurrent.
They would try to give this man a 90-year sentence. So whatever he does in prison, in terms of if they decide, okay, you need to work off. Sorry, I hate the term work off, but if you need to help to restore justice or whatever, right? Mm-hmm. He got to become like a doctor or something, because if you're doing it for 90 years, it has to be something that don't involve you lifting bricks and stuff. Mm. And that's another thing. We have to look beyond just this whole thing where, oh, we can let them work hard labor and stuff. Because once again, you're doing punitive justice as opposed to what could best restore the community.
Mm. Let's take this call. Good morning, caller. You're on the air.
Well, quality days, Dr. You know, it's along with you and
Stephen.
Stephen Dwight. Mm-hmm. Morning, Dwight. Brother. Couple of things. I also want, there's a person listens to your show, right? A lady. Mm-hmm. I want her to call me. When I finish making my comment, would you allow me to tell her to call me, please?
Okay. That's very unusual, but okay.
Sure, let's hear
okay.
Yours.
Now, okay. Now, the thing is, the Bible tells you if you should take somebody's life, somebody should take your life.
Your life is required.
That's the Old Testament. Uh-huh. I mean, yeah, the New Testament is a slightly different story, but okay.
Old Testament, but it's the Bible. They coincide with each other. The New Testament and the Old Testament.
Well, Jesus came to show us a different way, right?
Yeah, but the thing is, somebody has to, Christ Jesus paid for awesome. What we had done.
Yeah, he paid okay. for all sin, so we should let all the murderers go.
No, Stephen, I ain't going to be there. See, for the simple reason that this bunch of violence that's happening in our country, mm-hmm. it has to stop. And we can't go into year after year with the same old. The government and the police should work. If you take somebody's life, the government should take your life. The government has the right to do that. Other thing is,
I think it's happening. Bail is helping, so that's clearly the government doing what it needs to do.
Well, so I don't want any comment whereby people think they got license to take a person life, and you know you're going to go to jail and do a couple of years and come out. No, it doesn't. That's not right.
Well, nobody said that. Who said that?
Well. Nobody said it, but, I mean, according to Stephen, he implied that.
Oh, no, certainly did
Stephen
not.
Stephen did not imply that.
Not at all.
Stephen implied nothing.
In fact,
nothing
the complete
such.
Opposite. All
right.
Okay. That's the way I understood it. And if he hadn't done it, then I apologize. But that's the way I understood he was really saying.
No, the
you
way
know?
She didn't understand it. What I was
okay.
saying, what I was
okay.
saying was, one second. Because I want,
repeated again.
No, I want him and everybody else who listens to the radio, and for some reason, the frequency of their ears can't allow them to hear English.
To do what?
I want you to understand what I said.
Okay.
I'm saying that it doesn't make sense to just lock a person up, and the person who they offended, who they killed, the family that they destroyed, is still hurting and in need. So they should, while in jail, they need to be productive citizens and contribute.
Okay, I understood with you, but you missed my point. My point is, the scripture said, mm-hmm. if you want to take somebody's life, your life should be taken.
That's not.
And the thing is, the government has that prerogative to do it.
I want you to know that the scripture says a lot of things, and there are many instances, including City of Refuge,
including what?
A city of refuge where you are allowed to kill somebody and run to a city of refuge and you cannot be killed.
Yeah, we don't have that.
Ah, exactly. So stop quoting stuff you don't understand. Now, move on to your next point.
I don't want anybody to think that they
move
have the right
on to your next point.
To just kill people.
No one is saying that.
And come out. Well, when no you do that, you're hurting the whole family.
Yeah, well, the way that we do things in Bahamas seems to suggest that we do think that's fine. So that's
okay,
what we're saying.
Right?
That's what we have a problem with, right? These lenient sentences and concurrent sentences for heinous crimes. You deserve to be there for 100 years. And like Stephen says, working for the families is you destroyed. How about that?
You can't bring in rice back.
Oh my
goodness.
God. Okay, you wanted to say something to a woman who listens? Say it really quickly, please.
Say it again?
You wanted to make an appeal to someone who listens? Say it really quickly.
Yeah, but I want to make another comment before I call the police. Tell the police to call me.
Okay, we've got a lot of calls coming in, though. But
okay.
Really quick.
May I make the other comment?
Sure.
Huh?
Yes.
Okay. Now, the government, the politician from Africa, right? He was talking about how good this government are, right? Basically, he was talking about the prime minister. The thing is, the poor people in the Bahamas are not getting any help. And the thing is, it's causing a problem for everybody because they are squatting on people's land and the government who have rights to reconcile the situation are not doing anything about it. So, he don't know what's happening in the Bahamas, so he should just keep his mouth closed.
Now,
people are being hurt.
Okay.
Okay, my point is that, Max, root roll, would you call me, please? Bremen, of course. Thank you for your time, Dwight and Stephen.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much.
I go with you.
Oh, boy. Well, I mean, I don't know. Would you expect for a state visit for you? What you want him to say? What do you expect him to say? I don't understand. Who are you like call him out? Y'all are so worthless. You got poor people in this country. How? What do you want the state? Anyway.
Let's call.
Good morning, caller. You're on the air. Hi. Good morning. Are you there?
Hello.
Hi. Good morning.
Good morning, Dwight. Good morning, Stephen.
Morning.
Yeah, Dwight, I agree wholeheartedly with Stephen's concept. But as it relates to the state's visit, right, Dwight, you're quite correct. You know, you wouldn't expect anything better. He's not orientated with Bahamas, and he doesn't have a panoramic view like a citizen, right? A conscious citizen. But as it relates to the punishment, a little quick story here. But also, Dwight, firstly, the Bible can be used as a proof text, like Stephen said. And so I agree with Stephen's ideology. The Bible can be used as a proof text for anything.
Yeah.
There was a transgendered or LGBTQ spokesperson saying that Jesus is transgendered because he was born from immaculate conception that they call immaculate deception. So as it relates to what Stephen was saying, I had won some money from a friend years ago because he had told me that it wasn't in the Bible, you know, in Ecclesiastes, I guess, where it says the time to kill. So as it relates to what Bremen was saying, that means an eye for an eye, we'll all walk around blind, but in some instances, when people are killed, I don't think the person who killed them deserved a death penalty, because that's why the Bible says it's a time to kill. It's a time for everything under the sun. And this is what it is. So the Bible can be used as a proof text for everything. Okay? And it relates to what Stephen was saying also as far as punishment and the amount of time spent in jail. That's the only way out. You have to have this the balance between negative reinforcement and positive reinforcement, because I've had a friend, you know, I've known for years, been to the States, a number of them, let's say 10 years, one came out a master plumber, one came out a decent mechanic. The other one, I don't know what he did, but he came out, got in problems. I mean, he was still mixed up in problems, but he said, I'm sure some people don't change. So they had a video of him breaking into his sister's house that lives in the same yard with him. So what I'm saying is some people just don't change. You know, after 20-something years in jail, I was saying I would have been a doctor or somebody, because a mechanic or whatever, because of 20-something years in jail, come on, you should have at least, this, like Stephen was saying, this is the only way out. You have to have some type of mitigation as to the recycling door going in and going out and coming out with the same mentality. Otherwise, it's a futile system.
Yeah.
Especially over here, because you look at the hospital, let's say you look at the prison, obviously when people go in jail, you only call it a correction or rehabilitation center, but it's not.
Mm-hmm.
It's a farce. It's lesser.
Okay, thank you very much. Thank you very much. Let's read some messages as we go to the break. Isn't it interesting that when Bremen says, the person in prison giving the money back can't bring the person back. All right? So, okay. So what's the point of anything?
I mean, yeah, but you missed the point. Killing the person also, right, can't bring them back. So
exactly. What's that going to do?
Yeah, we passed that point. Like, we know
they're going to be healed immediately once you execute the person?
No. No, but that, and the point is that we are doing, we're trying to correct what we can correct, as opposed to, I want everybody to hurt because I was hurt.
Yeah. All right. Let's go to the break. Let me read some messages as we go. This person says here, oh boy, these Haitians are coming over here and committing crimes.
That's the one you choose to read, do I?
Didn't the minister suggest the flogging of these kinds of people in Rawson Square? I support this move. Which minister? And, okay, and they say, I guess it means Stephen, can't see the reason why people should live. I guess he considers himself a god when he doesn't make comments on the radio. What?
I can't see why people should live? Yeah. Or I can't... Wait, which one are they accusing me of?
It's just, this person says, Dwight, it's sad that you are losing your humane feeling. People are going through a lot in life. That father was struggling for friends, someone to talk to. I don't know what you're talking about. And that's all I've been saying, that, right? This is a very sad, sad story. And a child is dead.
And disturbing.
Right? This is what we've been saying, that people are struggling and need mental health assistance.
Yeah, but they don't see that as you being humane.
Mm.
Your humanity is you not saying anything at all, because, you know, that's how it works in the Bahamas. Humanity.
Oh, you mean don't talk about it.
Don't talk about it.
Because that would be humane.
Don't talk about the dad, even though they're rapists. Don't talk about the person beating their child. You don't know how hard a day they had at work. Don't talk about any of that stuff. That's the humane thing to do.
Oh, dear Lord. Okay, let's go to the break. This is Morning Blend on Guardian Radio 96.9.
Yes, I did. Yes, I did. But your lies ain't working. Lies ain't working. Now who's hurting? Now who's hurting? I had to shut you down. You thinking, bringing her into our home, in our bed, you must have fell and bumped your head, messing up my sheets, and violating me, got me about to call my peace, and take it to the streets, nothing you can do, and there's nothing you can say. Could persuade me to stay with you another day. You have crossed the line to the point of no return. What you do from here on out, I am no longer concerned. See, I heard it all before.
Let me explain.
Baby, it's not what you think. That's what you said to me.
But your lies ain't working now.
Look
who's hurting now.
Shut you down. Played the fool before.
You had a good game.
I must admit,
I was it.
But now it's over.
But your lies ain't working now.
Look who's hurting now.
Look who's hurting.
See, I had to shut you down.
I had to shut you down.
Ooh, I used to hang on to your every word.
This is Guardian Radio, 96.9 FM, Nassau, Bahamas.
I'm Rita Foley with an AP News Minute. The United Auto Workers Union has walked out on GM, Ford, and Stellantis over pay and benefits. UAW President Sean Fain says the companies have had a decade of record profits.
When they're profitable, it's all theirs. They want to keep it all.
Sean Fain heard there on WXYZ-TV in Detroit. GM CEO Mary Barra says GM is offering historic wage increases, but automakers say they're worried about labor costs. New England is getting ready for Hurricane Lee, which has weakened but is still a fierce storm. They expect rain and winds up to 80 miles per hour. John Lusty is in York, Maine, where he's with the York Harbor Marine Services, and he says boaters aren't taking any chances as they get ready for this storm.
The majority of the storm is hitting right at high tide, so... You just can't be prepared enough. It's better to be over-prepared than under.
I'm Rita Foley.
We'll be right back.
It's time for your first look at traffic for the morning, brought to you by RBC. Start your home journey with an RBC mortgage today. In your real-time traffic, as usual, Mile Butler Highway, your hot spot this morning. Heavy traffic from well south of the Fire Trail roundabout straight up to Tawny Quilliams Darling Highway. Traffic backed up along Tawny Quilliams Darling Highway as well. Westbound mainly to that roundabout with Mile Butler Highway. Glass Road is busy, especially near Fire Trail. And as you get closer to Munnings Road, northbound, you're going to see heavier traffic as well on the way to JFK. JFK, again, busy along Lake Cunningham, eastbound to the roundabout, and westbound to the roundabout with Gladstone and Bahamar Boulevard. Also eastbound, though, heading up to John F. Kennedy Drive and Prospect Ridge. Building traffic on Carmichael to Coral Harbor Road, and Blue Hill Road is busy near Cowpen, near St. Vincent, near Carmichael, and especially north of Soldier on the way to Independence Drive. Independence Drive eastbound to East Street, looking busy for you. And then there's Robinson Road, heavy traffic from Soldier Road, the intersection with Prince Charles Drive, straight up to East-West Highway. And Marathon Road also busy for you this morning, northbound to Wolf Road. Soldier Road busy straight through to Bernard, Wolf, and Village. Bernard Road, heavy traffic, westbound mainly, and near the schools in the area. And Eastern Road, you're not moving from San Suzy to about Johnson Road. That's westbound. Prince Charles Drive near Elizabeth Estates, also heavy traffic there. That's what we're looking at right now. We'll have another update for you after the 8 o'clock news. Morning event traffic brought to you by RBC. Visit rbc.com/take60seconds to connect with RBC today. Time for another check of your weather, brought to you by Easy Car Sales. Moderate swells along eastern coastlines will continue as Hurricane Lee gradually moves away from the area. A weak surface ridge of high pressure will continue to support high temperatures and light, gentle breezes across the islands, as well as a surface trough extending from Hurricane Lee will produce some scattered showers over the southeast Bahamas and portions of the central islands. So the hazardous marine conditions will continue as Lee moves away. And you will see life-threatening surf and dangerous rip currents due to significant swells. And so everybody's being advised to stay out of the waters if you are on the Atlantic coastlines of the islands. So that's the eastern islands especially. And Grand Bahama as well on the northern side there. And so you're still being advised to be careful on coastal roads. For all areas today, partly sunny with the chance of a few isolated showers or thunderstorms. Becoming fair and warm with a few passing showers tonight. Small craft operators advised to remain in port. Another hot day in store. Highs getting up to around 92 Fahrenheit, 33 Celsius. But the heat index will make it feel like it's 100 degrees. That's Fahrenheit, 38 Celsius. Overnight lows tonight getting down to about 80 Fahrenheit, 27 Celsius. In your extended outlook, our frontal boundary from the southeast U.S. will move towards our area this weekend. And that's going to stall, producing some showers and possibly thunderstorm activity across the northwest Bahamas. So for Saturday, tomorrow, in the northwestern islands, partly cloudy to cloudy, widely scattered showers and isolated thunderstorms, becoming warm and humid at night with isolated showers and thunderstorms. Elsewhere, a mix of sun and clouds, becoming fair and warm at night. Brief passing showers possible. Sunday, in the northwestern islands, partly cloudy to cloudy with scattered showers and isolated thunderstorms again, becoming warm at night with isolated showers and thunderstorms. Elsewhere, partly sunny, isolated showers and thunderstorms, becoming fair and warm at night. We'll have a closer look at the tropics coming up in our next weather check after the 8 o'clock news. This weather check brought to you by Easy Car Sales. Feel the power of the electric revolution. Swing by Easy Car Sales for a test drive in an electric vehicle. It's a ride you won't forget, and you'll be entered for your chance to win a tablet every week. Visit easy242.com and see where an electric future can take you.
Whether you're looking for your first or new home, or even using your existing home as equity, RBC understands that your journey to home ownership is unique, and your mortgage financing should reflect that. That is why, at RBC, we have dedicated mortgage specialists that provide sound advice and helpful solutions to make your dream home a reality. Best of all, the RBC mortgage team is mobile, flexible, and will meet you almost anywhere. Visit rbc.com/take60seconds to connect with an RBC mortgage specialist.
Don't spend hours sending individual messages to your customers. Use SMS messaging instead. With Cable Bahamas Business Solutions SMS messaging, you can send personalized messages to hundreds or even thousands of recipients instantly. It's quick, effortless, and cost-effective. Plus, it ensures that your messages are delivered directly to your customer's cellular phones, guaranteeing higher engagement. Save time and boost your outreach with SMS bulk messaging. Call Cable Bahamas Business Solutions at 601-8911 in Nassau or 602-8811 in the Family Islands.
Wherever you are in the world, Cleveland Clinic's world-class care is here for you. From Ohio to Florida to London, Cleveland Clinic treats thousands of patients every year, ranked number 2 in the world by Newsweek. You can trust our caregivers to enhance your experience across each step of your treatment journey. For every care in the world, learn more at clevelandclinic.org/Caribbean.
Baby, let me explain to you what I'm saying.
What you saying?
It's not even like that.
It wasn't like that, but I saw you.
Baby, I don't love her.
You don't love me? You know what? I don't even want to talk to you.
She don't mean nothing to me.
I don't want
to
see your face.
She was just telling me.
I just want to see you walking through that
baby,
door. There ain't nothing else to say.
Why we gotta do it like this? Baby, damn.
Come home late. It seems you barely beat the sun. Tapping my shoulder. Thinking you gon' get you some. Smelling like some fragrance that I don't even wear. So if you want some loving, I suggest you go back there. Where you came from. Day to day with you, it's always something else. Working my nerve. God knows that I don't deserve what you put me through. Cause I've been so true to you. For you to come at me with another.
This is Guardian Radio, 96.9 FM, Nassau, Bahamas.
Welcome back to Morning Blend here on Guardian Radio 96.9. We are streaming live on GuardianTalkRadio.com and on the Guardian Radio app for smart devices. We're also on your televisions on Cable Bahamas Channel 969 and BTC Flow Channel 612. You can tweet us at MorningBlend969 or Facebook.com/MorningBlend969 or text us on the Guardian Radio text line powered by BTC 422-4796. Standard text rates apply. And now at 8:22, time for another check of your weather for today. Brought to you by Bahamas First Insurance. So we've got a lot going on. We've got moderate swells along eastern coastlines that's going to continue as a result of Hurricane Lee, which is moving away from the area, going to be a problem for the northeastern United States and Atlantic Canada. We'll get to that in a bit. But a weak ridge of high pressure will continue to support high temperatures and light to gentle winds across the area. And a surface trough extending from Hurricane Lee will produce some scattered showers for the southeast and central Bahamas. So again, we're expecting the hazardous marine conditions to continue. And the conditions will be in the form of life-threatening surf and rip currents due to the swells generated by Lee. And everybody's being advised to stay out of the water, especially along Atlantic coastlines. And we are also expecting another hot day and heat indices in the triple digits. So you're asked to hydrate and stay out of the sun. So for all areas today, forecast calls for partly sunny conditions, chance of isolated showers or thunderstorms. becoming fair and warm with passing showers tonight. Small craft operators are advised to remain in port. Temperatures today getting around 92 Fahrenheit, 33 Celsius, but the heat index will make you feel like it's 100 Fahrenheit, 38 Celsius. Low temperatures tonight getting down to 80 Fahrenheit, 27 Celsius. In your extended outlook, a frontal boundary from the southeast United States will move towards the area this weekend, but it's going to stall and still produce some showers and thunderstorms across the northwest Bahamas. So for Saturday, in the northwestern islands, partly cloudy to cloudy, widely scattered showers and isolated thunderstorms, becoming fair and warm at night with isolated showers and thunderstorms. Elsewhere, a mix of sun and showers and clouds, and pretty much the same for Sunday. In the tropics, we've got Hurricane Margo still out in the Atlantic, no threat to anybody. We also have Central Tropical Atlantic, in the Central Tropical Atlantic, showers and thunderstorms showing some signs of organization now in association with a broad low pressure area about midway between the Lesser Antilles and the Cabo Verde Islands. Chance for formation through the next 7 days is pretty high, 90%. So we will watch that one in the coming days. But then we still have Hurricane Lee out there, and Lee is going to be an issue for our friends in the northeastern United States and southeastern Canada, likely to make landfall over the weekend. But that is Morning Blend weather, brought to you by Bahamas First. Visit firstonlineinsurance.com and select a Bahamas First agent to purchase, pay, or renew your car or home insurance 100% online, or just stop by any Bahamas First agent. Bahamas First, celebrating 40 years as the first Bahamian general insurance company. What's first for you comes first for us. Time for another check of your traffic for this morning, brought to you by RBC. Start your home journey with an RBC mortgage today. In real-time traffic, Eastern Road, still heavy traffic from San Susie straight up to about Johnson Road. And Fox Hill is going to be busy for you as well. If you're heading northbound toward Eastern Road, you're going to see it. It's going to be a long time for you to get out of there, unless you're heading east. And Bernard Road still busy for you as well. Westbound mainly. Prince Charles Drive still at the major intersections, heavy traffic, and Fox Hill and Prince Charles Drive especially. If you're heading northbound on Fox Hill toward Prince Charles, again, you've got a long wait ahead of you. And then it gets worse if you're on Prince Charles, if you're heading into Robinson Road. Once you get past Soldier, that long line there, straight up to East-West Highway, especially near Old Trail. Other issues for you, Marathon Road busy northbound this morning. Soldier Road near Old Trail, seeing heavy traffic there, and near Windsor Place. East Street, and Soldier, that whole area looking busy for you. And then there's Blue Hill Road, Blue Hill near Carmichael, but especially north of Soldier Road. Heavy traffic on the way to Independence Drive. Independence Drive back to both directions, especially westbound this morning. Milo Butler Highway, still heavy traffic there northbound from just south of the Fox Hill Fire Trail roundabout, straight up to Tawny Quim's Darling Highway. And Glass Road is busy for you as you get closer to Munnings Road on the way to JFK Drive and the roundabout there. JFK seeing some issues near Lake Cunningham and between the two roundabouts at Prospect Bridge and Bahamar Boulevard. Six-legged roundabout also seeing issues eastbound on JFK, southbound on New Providence Highway, northbound on Milo Butler Highway, and Farrington Road, southwestbound. So multiple directions of issues there. And West Bay Street, a bit of congestion at Saunders Beach, eastbound near roundabout with New Providence Highway. That's what we're looking at right now. That's your real-time traffic and your Morning Blend traffic alert, brought to you by RBC. Visit rbc.com/take60seconds to connect with RBC today.
Call serving all junior and senior high school students. You could win a brand new iPad for the new school year. Enter the Plato Alpha Design Essay Competition. All you have to do is write a strong and convincing essay on the topic, What Does Going Digital Mean to You? For junior high students, your word limit is 1,000 words. For senior high students, your word limit is 1,500 words. To enter, email your essay along with your name, school, and grade level, as well as your parents' contact information to alpha@platoalpha.com by Friday, September 22nd. The winners will be announced on Guardian Radio on September 29th. The winner for each category walks away with a brand new iPad. It's the Plato Alpha Design Essay Competition, powered by Guardian Radio 96.9 FM.
Want to know more about divorce, personal injury, wills, company formation, conveyances, and mortgages? Then sign up for Hulsbury Chambers' 16th Annual Free Legal Clinic, Saturday, September 23rd, 2023, Village Road North. Call 393-4551 to reserve your spot today. Space is limited. Lawyers available from 9 a.m. to 3 p.m. Consultations only. This is a community service event sponsored by Hulsbury Chambers.
There's a new electric vehicle in town. The Jack brand of SUVs, trucks, sedans, and commercial vans, available only at Easy Car Sales, home of the fully electric vehicle. For a powerful, smooth ride at a fraction of the cost to drive, leave the pump behind and hit the road with Jack. Visit easy242.com to see our brand new Jack models and drop into Easy Car Sales for a test drive. It'll have you singing.
Hit the road with Jack, and don't you pump gas no more.
It's back to school season again. Send your kids off with everything they need, from books, uniforms, to school supplies, all with a Fidelity personal loan. Apply today for a chance to win amazing back to school prizes. Call 352-6676.
Created Events and Marketing presents Becoming, a transformative women's empowerment summit that will take place on September 24th at the National Training Agency located on Gladstone Road at 3 p.m. Phenomenal speakers include DeQuessa Dean, Simone Bowe, Sherilee Pinder, Marissa Mason-Smith, and Dr. Nyambi Campbell-Dean. Not to mention a flaunted fashion show segment hosted by Miss Phyllis Garraway. Tickets are $50 and can be purchased at the Nassau Guardian or Essence Med Spa, number 15 Bradley Street, Palmdale. Proceeds will be donated to the Jenny Dean Caring and Sharing Cancer Support Group.
Dengue fever symptoms can range from mild to severe. Some common symptoms include fever, headache, nausea, vomiting, rash, muscle, bone, and joint aches and pain behind the eyes. Persons experiencing fever and two or more of these symptoms should see their healthcare provider, go to the nearest clinic, or call the Dengue Fever Hotline from Monday through Friday between 8 a.m. and 8 p.m. at 802-1143 or 814-4015 for assistance. This message is brought to you by the Ministry of Health and Wellness.
Whether you're looking for your first or new home or even using your existing home as equity, RBC understands that your journey to home ownership is unique and your mortgage financing should reflect that. That is why at RBC we have dedicated mortgage specialists that provide sound advice and helpful solutions to make your dream home a reality. Best of all, the RBC mortgage team is mobile, flexible, and will meet you almost anywhere. Visit rbc.com/take60seconds to connect with an RBC mortgage specialist.
At Wendy's, we are different. We don't just use beef. It's fresh, never frozen. Our burgers are square because we never cut corners. Served hot off the grill with fresh lettuce, tomatoes, onions, and American cheese. We believe in fast food done right. Always serving fresh, never frozen beef. Order a hot, juicy Dave single, double, or triple. Made with fresh, never frozen beef. Now only at Wendy's. Different inside and out.
Calling all junior and senior high school students. You could win a brand new iPad for the new school year. Enter the Plato Alpha Design Essay Competition. All you have to do is write a strong and convincing essay on the topic, What does going digital mean to you? For junior high students, your word limit is 1,000 words. For senior high students, your word limit is 1,500 words. To enter, email your essay along with your name, school, and grade level, as well as your parents' contact information to alpha@platoalpha.com by Friday, September 22nd. The winners will be announced on Guardian Radio on September 29th. The winner for each category walks away with a brand new iPad. It's the Plato Alpha Design Essay Competition, powered by Guardian Radio 96.9 FM.
It's been 35 years since Custom Computers was founded, and we'd like to celebrate that milestone by thanking you, our clients and customers. You've inspired 35 years of expert service and support, partnering with the world's leading brands like HP, Apple, and Microsoft. We take pride in setting the bar for what you expect and deserve from a homegrown Bahamian business. We're here to serve you when you need us. So call 396-1101. Custom Computers, raising the standard since 1987.
This is Guardian Radio, 96.9 FM. Fresh news, smart talk, quality.
Run away, right now, let's just run away. All that talk is killing me. One last shot, hold on to me. Oh, there's something I gotta say to you. There's somewhere we gotta go. Been out of sinking in the sand, chasing what we can, baby.
We are back here with Morning Blend on Guardian Radio 96.9. Twite Strawn, along with Stephen Hanna on Friday. Friday, thank goodness it's Friday, right? Coming up in business, we're going to be talking with the central bank about Sand Dollar and getting the update on how that is going, the rollout there. And that's just in a few minutes. But we continue talking about what's in the news. And let's get through the rest of your messages before we move on to another topic. So, yeah, earlier we were talking about restorative justice versus what we do here. And this person says here, I'm not confident that anyone in government has ever given a thought to the solution, restorative justice, that you two just expressed. It makes so much sense towards the well-being of our society. Perhaps it should be expressed in a paper or petition to governments in order to become a regular discussion in hopes of some movement towards its end. Sadly, Texter, plenty of people are aware of this. Many within the government are aware of this. Many cabinet ministers have proposed this when they weren't in the cabinet, and yet here we are. So what's that all about? Just more talk over and over, but the action that we need is not happening.
I won't even, to some extent, I can see where it might have been attempted to start. But clearly, it has not been seen all the way through. Because that's the only way I could understand work release programs.
It's not the same at all.
No, they're not the same, and that's the problem. But I'm saying, like, I could see where somebody's like, oh, well, we was testing out to see what would be the viability. And blah, blah, blah. No. You got to put it on paper and say this is the purpose of it. And it can't just be this person working for the sake of working. Where's the money going to? You know what I mean? But there's something else that we discussed right. Anyway, go ahead.
You remember it while I read the rest of the text messages. And then I want to move on to another story. This person says here, over the weekend, let's reflect on how many AGs we have had since independence and how many have advocated for the much-needed changes to our laws as much as they do for foreign interests. Or is this all in the hands of the PM? I hope...
The new Governor General, Cynthia Pratt, has her list of things she wants to see fixed. When the circus comes back to town next month. Y'all are hilarious. Why? Where are you getting this from? Huh? The what? Who?
She's the head of state.
Oh, my God. Okay. Do you all really think the country works like this? What's happening?
I don't like the way you talk about
it. No, because it's disturbing to me.
Royal Majesty.
Oh, my God.
Representative.
Wow. Huh? If she has a list, then she needs to run for office and be elected. And even that won't guarantee that the list will get done. What do you talk? Anyway. Okay. The problem in this country is not people getting bail. Cases take too long before they go to trial. Some, yeah. Like that one that was from 2009.
Yeah, but the person was 2017.
People from January who are out on bail right now. Accused of crimes that happened in January who are out on bail.
It depends on if you have the right lawyer. Who knows how to work the system? It's really a money issue. Because, like, if you have a public defendant, I don't think that you're going to get on bail as quickly as if you were, like, that person's like, I want a private lawyer.
Yeah.
And, like, and that young man, Norman,
mm-hmm.
who's representing himself,
oh boy,
he's not going to get bail.
Well,
he will be very much stationed inside Fossil.
Mm. Yeah. Well, hey, okay. Did I read the rest of that? Nothing to do with. Yes. Yeah, so they say it's. And when people lose faith in the justice system, then they take matters into their own hands. Nothing to do with praying and it being the last days and religion. It's about lack of enforcement and efficiency in the justice system.
Ah, now I remember what it was. It was the third place argument.
I had a whole next comment I wanted to make, but I have to ask, why take calls from that particular caller? He always seems to need to be corrected on what he thinks he heard and doesn't get the point of what is actually being said. And like a typical Bahamian, he references a portion of the Old Testament that's already been readdressed in the New Testament. Well, that sounds like every caller you're talking about there. I mean, I don't know who you mean specifically. I know who you mean, but I mean, that sounds like everybody.
It's not even about it being readdressed in the New Testament. In the Old Testament, that's not what it said. For example, the Ten Commandments does not say, thou shalt not kill. It's thou shalt not murder. That's two different things. You know what I mean? So it's like there are tons of things that people tend to quote, but they're not quoting what they think they're quoting. So you got it wrong the first time. Mm. You know, so like it's not even that we need to address what it said. Because you're not saying what it said.
Mm. This person says here, gents, so you answer me this. Do you feel, and they have a lot of murder victims' names, I don't want to call them, but lots of people who, well-known cases of victims of horrible murders. The killers in those cases should not be put to death. We will never get killings down because our leaders are joking. This country is ridiculous.
I mean, if you're asking me personally if I would... If I had the choice between somebody being killed because they killed somebody or somebody who killed somebody being held responsible for the destruction that they've done and being forced to work to undo the horrible damage that they've done to the people who will be alive, whether they're alive or not, I'm going to pick the second one. You know what I'm saying? Like if somebody... It's always been interesting to me. I remember once somebody broke into my house, stole my computer, and the police came by and they said, oh, we found the person who stole your computer. We want you to come and testify. Well, one, I did not witness the person steal the computer. Two, you did not bring me back my computer. What am I testifying about? You want me to send this person to jail? You've confiscated the goods. It never made it back to me? Are you a proof that he stole it, but it never made it back to me? So how does that help me? I still don't have a computer. He's no longer free. The only person who wins is the people at the police auction. I don't win.
The what now?
I'm just saying. Right? So it's like, you tell me, audience, which one makes sense. If somebody steals your car and you don't have a car, do you want to be able to have your car back or a car back? Or do you want to say, no, throw the person into prison?
Well,
Well,
I'm saying, which one would you rather be walking in? But you happy to walk in the hot sun?
The time when my car was stolen, I was wishing very bad things.
I understand. And in anger, yes.
And I did never get that car back. But
I'm saying, now imagine if somebody came to you and say, here are the options. We found the person who stole your car. They can either go to jail, and while they're in jail, they will make enough money to buy you a brand new car of your liking, or we can murder them in front of you. Which one do you want? And if you're dumb hip, pick, I will walk in the hot sun just so I can see the person get murdered, then you deserve to be sunburnt to death as well.
Really?
Because you're dumb.
That's the extreme.
You know what I'm saying? Because you'd rather, instead of being restored to where you were left or beyond where you were, you would rather just see somebody else suffer. That doesn't make sense. Mm. And that's what I'm saying. I'm saying, hey, something bad has happened. We have an opportunity where we could fix society. We can make it at least slightly better than it is now or it was.
So to the texter, the issue is, as we have learned, we've seen that sometimes the police get it wrong. Sometimes people see things that they didn't really see. And so you've got all kinds of people who are accused of things they didn't quite do. They might have been associated, but they didn't do it. So the risk there is dangerous. It's one of the major arguments against capital punishment, right?
But even if I knew the person did it.
But even if you do. Like has come up. It's not really going to change anything. But if that person could work to make things a bit better for the victim's families,
right?
The
victim's community,
for the whole country,
right?
Maybe that might be a better way, because you just remove that.
Killing the person does not...
Irritant there. You still have lots of irritation around.
It doesn't help. The breadwinner is gone from a family. It doesn't help. And in the world that we live in, mothers and fathers are the breadwinners. So
but I don't want to get too distracted, because the initial talk was that the lenient sentences were causing issues. I mean, because we don't even... When was the last time? Capital punishment, what's the point of even talking about that? It's not going to happen here. We're talking about the sentences that people do get. And this
I just want
love, it seems, of concurrent sentences when these folks deserve much longer sentences.
Listen, if you're going to be in jail for 80 years, you need to be doing something.
And that was where Stephen brought that up, right? Because if you're going to be there that long, then at least be contributing to
society,
to the country.
Yeah.
Which is a great point. Absolutely. All right. This person says, please tell me you guys where you guys go to detox, because you guys put up with a lot of nonsense. As a supervisor, I'm dealing with the same issues where people engage their tongue before their brain. We all have our ways of coping.
Is that Lipton that you're drinking?
That's what it says. This one says they can't administer justice for all these murderers, much less restorative justice. Now I see you think you have it backwards. Right, I think it would be easier to do the restorative justice than what we're doing right now. And what we're doing right now is just causing more problems, which is what, shooting everybody out on bail. That doesn't make any sense. Come on. Anyway, this person says here, calm down, Dwight. The same way you think I'm crazy repeating focus on the same governor generals, the same way folks look at you with the local government talk. Okay, well, one of us is talking sense, though. The it's point is to repeat to repeat how insane we are until we change it. What? Don't drink your own Kool-Aid. We know nothing seriously changes here in Bikini Bottom. Oh, so you're trying to say you were being sarcastic with the brat. Is that what the text is saying? I'm not being sarcastic about local government. So why would you do that?
You want to know sad?
That doesn't make sense.
The Jonestown Massacre, it wasn't Kool-Aid, it was Flavor-Aid.
Yeah.
And Kool-Aid has been taking that hit ever since. It was a different company.
Does anybody really like Flavor-Aid, though?
We used to sell it in the Bahamas.
Yeah. But that was when you...
I think we just don't get it anymore.
Because it's disgusting.
Is it?
It is, truly.
Anyway, I won't say anything about the existing brand.
Truly. Anyway, I find it really weird when people tell non-believers they need to do X, Y, Z because it is in the Bible. The Bible is not their instruction book. Okay, texter, thank you for that. This is a scary text here. Dwight, the fact that police act with impropriety, we don't need anyone convicting anyone else to death. Yeah, that's what he said. He did say that. Stephen's basically asking to implement slavery to work for someone. You kidding me? That's what...
I'm not asking for it. And also that already exists. What are you talking about? What do you think the work release program is?
And they are working.
Right.
They do make money.
I'm asking for the distribution of whatever is produced and the funds that are created to go back to restoring the person who is wrong.
And where are these criminals supposed to work? Should they be employed at Guardian Radio?
I mean,
you drive a Honda, Dwight. Well, first of all, how dare you? How dare you insult me like that? And secondly, what's wrong with you, Dexter? What's going on here?
Because they have a mindset where it's like the only thing that you could do with somebody who's a criminal is kill them.
I mean, the corrections department has talked about all the things they have going on in there, right? They make the license plates, and they have other things that they can be doing.
But here's the thing.
There's all kinds of things they can do.
These are persons who are in society, right? The only difference is that they did an action that resulted in them being behind bars. There are a lot of people outside of bars who also did that action and got away with it, right? And that could be anything from murder, rape, to thieving money.
But you'd rather
the whole point is you're saying that there's tons of things that they can do, and the way that they say, oh, they can work at Guardian Radio, maybe they will. Maybe some of them already do. Oh, who knows?
Please, right?
The whole point is. If the people can contribute to society, let them contribute so society can be better, as opposed to, because we're still, if they're in jail, we are still paying for their existence.
Well, it's obvious. The people have bloodlust. They just want to see people get killed. And that's why we continue to have people out there getting murdered every day.
You want to see people get killed, and that's what they're doing. They're doing what you want them
this
to do.
People are
murdering.
No one's doing anything about it. Right. The lawmakers aren't making it more difficult. Lawyers are defending people to get out of bail for murder, right? They're like, yeah, he's not going to be a flight risk. He's not in a gag. Come on.
He's going to be a flight risk because he's going to die before he gets to the airport.
The prosecutor says, we want him in jail for his own safety. Yeah. And attempted murder he was charged with because, you know, not about the safety of those who might be killed again or attempts might be made to kill them again.
He's not.
It's about
him. He's not good at it, so.
So don't worry.
Yeah, don't worry. He's a failure at
Plus
even
he's
murder.
He's
going
to die soon anyway. Let's take these calls really quickly. Good morning. You're on the air.
Hey, good morning, Brian, and good morning, Chester.
Stephen. You're all getting very bad at this. Very bad. Okay. Stephen on Fridays, Chester on Wednesdays.
Okay. Good morning, Sir Stephen. I do apologize.
It's not sir. I don't subscribe to the monarchy, good morning. Good morning.
I'm left a bit confused on your computer story. But I do understand it because I'm trying to figure out what are you going to testify about. You never saw the computer to say yes or no, that is or is not my computer.
Yeah.
So I'm left confused as to why they would still want you to testify. I called because I had a similar situation. It wasn't a computer. It was my nephew's dad that was murdered. And they say they caught the person. And when I said to them at the AG office, I said, listen, I know how you guys go. You pick up anybody for anything. I said, if you're any short of that, the person, I said, please don't take that young man to court for something he did not do. I don't care what else he have done. It was not my nephew's murder, so I don't want that because I know the story surrounding my nephew's murder. Mm-hmm. I said, please don't call us again until you have somebody that you know is responsible. Do you know that was 2014? We've not received a call back yet.
Mm.
Okay, so I understand their things behind trying to get you to testify because they're just trying to throw any and everybody in jail.
Yeah.
You understand me? But I do believe in restorative justice when it comes to stolen products. I don't believe in it when it comes to murder because you cannot. There's no price you can pay to replace a life.
Well, no. So okay, Carla, before you go, right? And so we're not saying necessarily this is going to be equal to the person's life, but I'm just saying, like, for example. Somebody kills a father who has several children, right? And is helping to pay rent. That family now is in a worse financial situation. The children might have been in private school. Even if they're in public school, now they got a question if they're going to be able to buy books and uniforms. If the person who has been arrested, we know hanging in hopping. So this person going to be in jail, $16,000 a year, I think it is, to keep them inside Fox Hill. It might be more or less, right?
Mm-hmm.
We already paying that out of our pockets as the public. If this person is able to somehow, while they're in jail, do some work that allows them to make, and I put that in quotation marks, let's say $20,000 a year, right? They could pay for their stay at Fox Hill, and the rest of the money could go to helping to pay for the books and the clothes and stuff. And it will not replace the life of the father. That's why we're not letting them out. But at the same time, it is going to not allow that family to fall away through the cracks and fall on hard times because, well, we already put the person in jail. What more you want us to do? And that's all I'm suggesting.
Well, yes, I do agree with that. That actually makes a lot of sense because while we were talking about it, I was thinking that, okay, so then this person will have to be responsible to take care, to assist this family until the kids at least come of age.
Right. Yeah.
Okay. That actually makes a lot of sense. I don't see why it's not done. Because these guys, you know, if I said, but these guys are working. Mm-hmm. We all know that they are out there working. I see them from time to time. After a while, they don't use the prison uniform anymore.
Right.
Then they get, I guess, to a trustee level. They then come out in their regular clothes and they go on regular jobs, construction jobs, gas stations, wherever. They place them and they are making money and they're pocketing these money set aside for when they come out. They can do themselves and their families a huge favor.
Right.
I feel like yes. Restorative justice need to go straight across the board.
All right.
I agree with that.
Thank you so much, Carla. Right.
And I think people are getting the wrong idea. People are asking here if Stephen will be okay with criminals working next to him since he's an
advocate.
They do.
Don't
be. But I mean, we're not saying that. Yeah, you're accused of 3 murders and you get to work in an office. In air conditioning, and like no, we're not. No one's saying that.
It depends which office. Right? It depends which office. But, go
but
ahead.
Right there at the prison where you belong, but you work.
Yeah,
right?
There are things that you can do.
There are all kinds of things that can be done.
Right, and like some of these people, like there's farm work that needs to be done. Listen, I want you to know there are tons of jobs that people are like, oh, I don't want to do this job. I don't want to do that job. There's that, but there are also jobs where. This is specialized labor that you need to train somebody for 5 to 6 years to do.
I think it's hilarious. The person said you're advocating slavery, but they'd rather just execute them. Okay.
Yeah.
So, all right. I mean, it's not slavery. They get paid.
Right.
But
I'm not,
some of the money goes back to the people they hurt.
I'm not advocating slavery.
Yeah. All right. So the person is clarifying when they asked if I drove a Honda wasn't to insult me.
Indentured servitude.
So one of the type of people who drive Hondas. Not all, of course, but you know how many of them are. No, they were saying because I said my car had been stolen. No, it wasn't a Honda. They don't only steal Hondas around here. They'll steal anything.
Nissan.
They'll steal any old thing. That was a Mazda. Of all things.
Wow.
Of all things. Of course they do. But I don't know why anyone would steal that one. But yeah, it was a while ago. Still traumatized. Good morning, caller on the air. No. Hi, good morning. Are you there?
Mazda is the god from the Zoroastrian religion, right?
Okay, what's that have to do with anything?
It's weird.
Thank you. Good morning, caller on the air. Are you there? What's going on? All right. So a couple more messages, and then I want to quickly get to something else that's in the paper. This person says, one of the first principles taught in criminology, supported by research, is that the certainty of punishment is a greater deterrent than the severity of punishment. Criminals commit crime because they believe they will get away with it, not because they are afraid of the length of the respective sentence.
That's interesting.
Mm.
Yeah, for sure. If you're going to get catch, it don't even matter. Mm.
I agree that we need consecutive sentencing and harsher penalties for major crimes. For material things, I agree with restitution. For murder, I support work from jail with funds directly sent to the family. That's what we're saying.
Okay.
That's what you meant, right? That's
yeah,
what
yeah,
I
no,
meant.
No, yeah.
That's definitely what I meant. You can't be walking around the street doing everything like everybody else, like everything's fine.
I mean,
no.
It depends. If you're a neurosurgeon, maybe.
Hmm?
If you're a neurosurgeon,
murderous neurosurgeon should get to operate on people because he's a neurosurgeon.
Dwight, are you going to tell me that the only person who could take
put your hands
a tumor
anybody.
out of your
that's
brain
right. well, then,
is this person?
That's fine.
You'd be like, no, he killed somebody in the 80s. Okay.
No. It's okay.
I would.
He's not the only one. We can find somebody else.
He's the best.
That's fine.
He's the best.
Consult.
fine.
From your jail cell.
He consults.
Give some recommendations to the doctor.
The satellite thing where the teleconference thing. Yeah, fine. I don't, whatever.
Oh, no, I don't even want that. No, that's all right. Nah, that's a bit much.
We'll discuss it. It's a bit, okay.
Anyway. But the family should have that choice. If the murder is particularly heinous, give them bail and let the streets have them. I see, why do you all do this?
Because they want the blood.
Oh, my goodness.
And they think, for some reason, they think that the blood on the streets is going to make the air cooler or the land more fertile. It doesn't. Blood, the iron from the hemoglobin from a murder victim does not make the crops grow any better.
Didn't they say that the people around the neighborhood have to clean up because the police don't do it?
The police ain't dying their job.
Right.
So
I mean, boy. Anyway, so we talked about this a lot yesterday. Just want to read this. This is an article in the Tribune. Human Rights Bahamas is a text who's always calling for them to have more to say about things. They are saying that the police force should disclose the reward officers will receive through the new arrest incentive program. They're calling the competition ill-conceived. Police Commissioner Clayton Fernander defended the competition on Wednesday. A leaked memo said the competition is designed to foster teamwork and boost morale and recognize outstanding performance. Performance, interesting word. The system awards points to teams based on the number of arrests made for major or minor offenses. It also includes points for stopping and searching. Wow. It says go to page 4, but there's nothing on page 4 about this.
No, that is the stop and search thing to me is a problem because honestly, this week I was like, you know, certain people in this studio will dye the gray out of their hair, right?
You know,
but I don't. And you know what?
One day when you are sued.
But I won't. Because.
You really.
Let me tell you why I won't, right? I finally aged out of the demographic where police randomly will harass me because they're like, oh, I could.
Because of the gray hair?
Right. My hair is gray now. And I'm older than most of the police who will do random stops. Mm-hmm. But when I was younger. They look at somebody like me and like, oh, yeah.
We all experienced it.
Right.
Yes.
Now, the only problem is the senior police, who are still slightly older than me and hate me because of what I say on the radio, they'll send the little foot soldiers to harass me.
I'm sure that does not happen.
That has happened. You know that happened, right?
No, I don't know.
You want me to call the exact date when it happened? Anyway, right? The whole point is.
I can see why. Sometimes I think you might need a little harassment.
Oh, boy. Anyway. But the whole point is, I do not, that whole like, oh, you get extra points for randomly stopping somebody and searching them. For what? For what? That's ridiculous. That's harassment. Mm-hmm. And I can't support something like that.
But that's very dangerous. And we're looking for trouble. And I need calmer heads within the government to step forward and stop this.
And then it's only half a step from that to arresting a bunch of people because they resisted arrest. And like the only charge they have is resisting arrest. And it's like, why were you resisting arrest? Because this person came up to me and stuck their hand in my pocket. That is physical assault. Mm-hmm. You were sexually assaulting me, you filthy animal. Right?
Okay.
No, because how dare you reach your hand inside my pocket?
Stay inside this weekend, Stephen Hanna. This text, Human Rights Bahamas says it is deeply concerned by the revelation that the Royal Bahamas Police Force is offering rewards to officers for making arrests. The police are already paid to do their job. If the leadership of the Royal Bahamas Police Force believes salaries for officers are too low, they should petition the government to raise them across the board, not create the atmosphere of a competitive hunt in which members of the public are the prey. Human Rights Bahamas calls on the police force to disclose whether the ultimate reward for this competition is financial, and if not, what it does involve. Certainly, we urge the Minister of National Security to step in and bring an end to this ill-conceived scheme.
I hope it's financial. Because I would hate to go to jail because somebody went a dinner for two at some random restaurant that was about to close down anyway. Like, come on.
Well.
Could you imagine the way? Well, you're being harassed beyond belief because somebody's like.
Sauteed chicken.
Yeah, you for a bow tie from some place that doesn't that sells bow ties. I don't know.
Yeah, the officer doesn't even wear them. He doesn't even like them. National Security Minister Wayne Monroe previously dismissed the competition as fake news. He's currently out of the country, conveniently. Human Rights Bahamas said that given the rate of police brutality claims, a competitive arrest system is a, quote, powder keg waiting to explode. We are already dealing with an alarmingly high rate of police brutality claims and officer-involved killings. Officers are routinely accused of threatening and torturing suspects to obtain coerced confessions, and videos of police misconduct of various kinds have proliferated in recent times. Mm-hmm. At the same time, violent crime has placed even the most well-meaning and professional officers under extreme stress to achieve results. There's no question that such an incentive scheme runs a huge risk of enticing officers to make false arrests on little or no evidence, seriously violating the human rights of members of the public as a result. It could easily spin out of control with catastrophic and far-reaching consequences for the public's faith in law enforcement. Now, of course, we told you this yesterday. In defending the scheme, Commissioner Fernandez said that these programs exist elsewhere. Okay, well, anyway. Nonetheless, it is common for such methods to be criticized abroad when discovered by the public.
And I said, they are also condemned elsewhere, so...
Oh, boy. It's wonderful how convenient it is when we use that it's used elsewhere thing. Yeah. But when good things are working elsewhere, you know where I'm going.
You can't just put things.
No, that's not going to work. We're very small. We're very corrupt. Yeah. We're very this.
You know, anyway, I would tell you something. What? Go ahead. Answer the phone.
Let's take this call. We're running out of time for this segment, but so let's take this call really quickly. Good morning, caller. You're on the air.
Yes, good morning.
Hi.
Good morning.
My big issue is, right? Mm-hmm. Everyone seems to forget that the Minister of National Security came out and said this is all fake news. Mm-hmm. I'm like,
no one's forgotten.
Everyone's forgetting that part.
No one forgot that. That's been said every single time the story.
Yeah. Since then, the commission said it is real, and we're shocked that that memo was leaked.
Yes, but no one's saying the National Security Minister might have...
He just said
made
it.
...a mistruth, right? But anyway...
Maybe he didn't know.
Yeah, right. Okay. Anyway... So then the commissioner says he wants to condemn the person that leaked the information. Mm-hmm. But we should be thanking the law that someone did leak the information. Otherwise, it would have been fake news, and they would have been saying it doesn't happen.
Well, only certain crimes are crimes.
So how could we have faith in the National Security Minister or the police force if they're trying to say, okay, we're condemning the person who leaked the document? How would not lie to the people and just admit it was true?
Mm-hmm. Well, that's fine, but I want someone to come and say, okay, this is crazy, we're not going to do this, and we've advised the police force to cease and desist.
But
right?
That's what I'm saying.
So it's been 2 days now. Yeah.
He's off the island.
He's not the only one who can respond to this, right? Come on, say something. This could end badly.
But
when they talk about whistleblower protection...
For who?
I mean, in general, because we need more whistleblowers to expose things just like this.
Yeah. Well, don't get distracted by that one. Worry about that the flashing lights behind you over the weekend. What could happen, right?
The flashing lights? First of all,
I have a suggestion. What you could do is offer them your own incentive.
What?
Yeah,
what now?
That's
we got to cut you right there. Now you're really looking for trouble. Okay.
How much does it cost for
you stop. Whatever, that was not going to end well either.
It never ends.
Good luck to everybody for this weekend and be safe.
It's not hard.
We're going to take a break. When we come back after the news, we're going to be talking with the central bank about Sand Dollar, where things stand at this point. This is Morning Blend on Guardian Radio 96.9.
All that talk is killing me. One last shot, hold on to me. Oh, there's something I gotta say to you. There's somewhere we gotta go. Been out of sinking in the sand.
There's a new electric vehicle in town. The Jack brand of SUVs, trucks, sedans, and commercial vans. Available only at Easy Car Sales, home of the fully electric vehicle. For a powerful, smooth ride at a fraction of the cost to drive, leave the pump behind and hit the road with Jack. Visit easy242.com to see our brand new Jack models and drop into Easy Car Sales for a test drive. It'll have you singing.
Hit the road with Jack and don't you pump gas no more.
Take some advice from your Aunt Angie. If you're going to invest in an exotic pet, choose anything but a Norwegian forest cat. Apparently, they will eat all your jewelry. Before you know it, you're racing to the vet when your cat escapes from his carrier and lunges for your earrings. You crash and your cat swallows your pearls. Mm-hmm. But if you're smart, you'll have CG Motor Insurance and get the best comprehensive coverage for the price.
Get the best comprehensive coverage for the price. CG Atlantic Insurance Agents and Brokers. Good like that. All benefits are subject to policy provisions, including eligibility at the time of service.
Summer your way with Scotiabank. Apply for a Scotia Plan loan this summer and open the doors to your dream destination, the perfect home renovation, a prep for back to school, and so much more. Enjoy competitive rates, flexible loan terms, and no payments for up to 2 months. Use your plan loan to unlock your perfect summer break. Apply for your Scotia Plan loan today and have summer your way with Scotiabank. Visit bs.scotiabank.com or call 242-356-1697 for further details.
Want to know more about divorce, personal injury, wills, company formation, conveyances, and mortgages? Then sign up for Hulsbury Chambers' 16th Annual Free Legal Clinic, Saturday, September 23rd, 2023, Village Road North. Call 393-4551 to reserve your spot today. Space is limited. Lawyers available from 9 a.m. to 3 p.m. Consultations only. This is a community service event sponsored by Hulsbury Chambers.
This is Guardian Radio, 96.9 FM, Nassau, Bahamas.
This is Guardian Radio, your station for up-to-the-minute news, intelligent, interactive, and engaging conversation, 96.9 FM. The views and opinions of the hosts and guests are their own and do not necessarily reflect the position of the management and staff of Guardian Network.
Wake up, it's a new day. Wake up, it's a new day.
Good morning and welcome to Morning Blend Business on this Friday, September 15th, 2023. Welcome back to our Morning Blend listeners. Once again, I'm Dwight Strawn along with Stephen Hanna. And this morning we are talking about Sand Dollar, the central bank's digital currency. And here to tell us all about it and give us an update on where things stand and some of the exciting things happening with Sand Dollar. Very pleased to welcome to the show. Were you here before?
Yes.
I think so. Right? Well, we talk so often that it feels like you were here before. Yeah. But anyway, she's here in person, assistant manager in the currency department at the Central Bank of the Bahamas, Chandra Newton. Thank you very much. Great to have you with us.
It's great to be here. Thank you.
In the studio, right?
Yeah.
All right. So just for those who... everybody by now has heard of Sand Dollar, right?
I would hope so. We're working hard. We're really working hard in the Sand Dollar Adoption Unit to get it out there. So,
But definitely some people are confused.
and don't know all the information about it. So briefly, just summarize as simply as you can what Sand Dollar is all about and what it's not, because that seems to be the bigger problem there, what it is not.
Yes. So Sand Dollar is the digital version of the Bahamian dollar. Consider it, look at it as just cash, having cash on your phone. So you use it, it's mobile phone-based technology, and it's not a cryptocurrency. So you cannot make money on Sand Dollar. You cannot lose money on Sand Dollar. 10 Sand Dollars today is not going to be worth 20 Sand Dollars tomorrow or 5 Sand Dollars tomorrow. Mm-hmm. It's just, it's one-to-one with the Bahamian dollar. All you're doing is several ways you can load funds to your, the same way you require a physical wallet to put cash. You have cash in a physical wallet. You need a digital wallet to hold Sand Dollars. And there are about 7 authorized Sand Dollar enabled digital wallet providers. They include Canoe, Sun Cash, Cash and Go, Mobile Assist, Money Max, Island Pay, and I hope I'm not missing anyone anyone else out. I'll look at my list here and be sure to include them before we leave if I did. But yeah, you just a couple of ways to load the funds in your digital wallet. There are kiosks that many of these wallet providers have, similar to an ATM machine, where you load cash in it, you scan your phone, and now those funds are on your phone. You can over-the-counter walk into any of the wallet providers' locations who have a location. Mm-hmm. So a number of ways to get Sand Dollars in your digital wallet on your phone.
Mm-hmm. All right, so people are asking, everywhere I go, people ask me, why Sand Dollar, and are you all trying to phase out paper money?
Not at all. So we are not trying. Cash is not going anywhere. Sand Dollar is a solution, and it's not replacing cash, and it's not replacing debit and credit cards. It's a solution when accessing cash is a challenge or it's inconveniencing. Mm-hmm. So for those on islands where there are no banks or banks are miles apart, you know, this is a solution, you know, for that. In those instances, one of the things that I hate when I walk into a business place and I've already gotten the items that I'm wanting to purchase, or I'm on the drive-through line and I get to the window and I hear the credit card machine is down. Mm. The cashier tells me, you know, the credit card machine is down and I don't carry cash.
Yeah.
So now I got to go and, you know, head over to a bank and to an ATM machine. But with Sand Dollar, as long as that business is accepting Sand Dollar, that quote-unquote cash is on my phone. Mm-hmm. And it's just simply scan and pay.
Yeah, yeah, you're right.
Oh, yeah, I was going to ask. well, how, I mean, I don't want to jump this poor lady. But the use of Sand Dollar, getting people to accept Sand Dollar as money, right? I feel like a step is being missed.
Okay.
Right? And I understand that, you know, wallets are there for whatever reason. I've heard rumors and mumblings. Are the banks going to start providing wallets so that Sand Dollar, like, we don't necessarily have to go download a third thing? I already have a bank account. I already have online banking. If it is money and the bank deals with my money, is there a way for a bank to just issue me automatically a Sand Dollar wallet so that I could have an easier transition between using Sand Dollar as opposed to having the adoption of Sand Dollar?
Okay, before you answer that, but isn't that what online banking is, though? I mean,
no, but my online banking, it's not like I could use my online banking to, like, I can't do a QR code the same way Sand Dollar works. Because I could go up to a register with my Sand Dollar wallet and pay with Sand Dollar. I can't do that with my phone doesn't allow me to do that with my bank.
Well, it sounds like the bank is a problem.
Well, I'm sorry, does your bank do that?
No, it doesn't.
Okay, so it sounds like all our banks have problems there.
But you do have the debit card.
Yes, but like she's saying, what if the card's down?
Okay.
Yeah,
right? I'm saying, so, but like, if there's a wallet across, and I'm talking about just generally the adoption of it, because I see the benefit of Sand Dollar even for, like, say, roadside vendors. Right?
Yeah, absolutely. Definitely.
I won't get robbed in the middle of the night because I don't have any physical cash on me.
Right.
And so you won't have people saying, oh, it's not about this hat, I need to go.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
There's, and it's not even just roadside vendors. You have even brick and mortar businesses who don't want to accept credit and debit card payments because they don't want to pay the fee.
Right.
There's a, right through the corner where I work, through Charlotte Street, there's a really lovely restaurant that has great food, and they lose, trust me, they lose a lot of my money, and I know a lot of other people's money, because they don't accept credit and debit card. It's cash only.
Right, well, that's a different type of robbery you're talking about. But the whole point is, what is preventing, if we're talking about adoption, because money, it's money.
Yeah.
Right? So what is, why not have the existing financial institutions be a part of that process of getting the general public?
They will become. I can say that right now, Bank of Bahamas is in a pilot, a pilot phase. But there's room, you know, there's room for everyone. And these right now, there's over just in the last update, there's over 113,000 wallets, and the wallets are growing. Every month, the wallets are wallet downloads and new wallets are growing, and these. Current wallet providers, they do have a very strong customer base as well.
And are there fees with the wallet?
So there's providers? there's no with SandDollar, there's no fees when it's person to person. So SandDollar, there are three wallet tiers, right? When you download one of the wallet providers right in the App Store and you set it up really quickly, name, email, address, you get a tier one SandDollar wallet.
And that caps out at how much?
And that caps out at $500. At any given one, at any given point in time, you can only hold $500. And that's because it doesn't require any KYC documents. It doesn't require you to upload any kind of identification. So that's
the answer to Stephen's question right there, why the banks are not on board
right.
yet.
You, and you have a lot of people who are not able
want
to get...
to make you pay for this service.
And you have a lot of people who are not able to get a bank account as well.
But I'm saying, I understand the part of it is for the unbanked, right? What I'm saying is that for the multitude of persons who are banked, to get them, because if you want money to work, money only works if we all come in agreement that it is money. Right? It's a philosophical idea more than it is an actual reality. So it's like, if I say, hey, I'd like to give you this thing in exchange for this other thing, the more a person, the more persons who are saying that, the more people say, oh, well, I need to get this thing, or I need to figure out how to get this thing. And so if we already have, you say 100,000 people have wallets, but if we already have 300,000 people with bank accounts,
right,
then that would be, to me, that would be an easier transition. And then we could have these additional third-party wallets if they do additional things or magical things or whatever, but
Well, one of the big challenges is that quite a number of our banks here are not local; they're international banks, and so with international banks, they typically want to have sort of the same standards and processes regionally. And they don't really kind of just hone in on just one particular market, the Bahamian market.
That sounds like a them problem. I'm not blaming you. That sounds like a them problem.
It is. Okay. So there also you have other countries in the region who are also looking at central bank digital currencies. They're, you know, kind of waiting to see what happens with those countries and how they can now incorporate, you know, standards for the entire region. So it's I think that's one of the big challenges, is the fact that there are a lot of international banks.
I think a lot of people are wondering the same thing that Steve was asking, but I think the issue is, I mean, you don't personally have an issue with the wallet providers.
Right? Oh, no, I don't have an issue with the wallet providers because I have one on my phone.
Right. Yeah.
Right? I have SandCash, but because I believe in the idea of SandDollar.
Yeah.
And I see the value of it, because even as a person who makes content online, right? I have a PayPal account.
Yep.
But it is nearly impossible to get the money off of PayPal into the local economy. So all the money I make online, I end up spending online internationally, right? As opposed to spending it locally.
Yeah.
And so that's ridiculous. Now, if I could have digital currency and spend it locally, if I could use that to pay electricity bills. I use that to put minutes on my phone. Mm-hmm. And I'm saying with SoundDollar, I can.
Yeah.
In some people, because there's some people who have it on their website and it don't work. But that's a different thing. I can tell you about them.
We'll get to that.
Because it's advertised with Dwight, so I would call their name.
Okay. So, but the issue is, though, I think, is the getting the money from your bank account to your SoundDollar wallet through these providers. And has that been sorted out? Can you transfer money from your account?
I can.
Yes, you can. So
across the board?
Yes. So two ways. One, ACH top-ups. So the same way you would do a bank transfer, like if I wanted to send you money and I would say, give me your Scotiabank or your First Caribbean, whomever, you know, whatever bank you use, and your account number, the branch, and all of that. Your wallet, your SoundDollar wallet has an account number. Mm-hmm. The bank is Central Bank and the branch is SoundDollar. However, not all of the wallet providers have completed the implementation of this feature within their wallets. Yeah, the only wallet provider who has is SunCash.
Yeah.
In the SunCash app.
So this is where you have the issue.
No, I have SunCash. I don't have this issue.
Right. So for the others, do you have a problem?
The others do have where you can link your debit. Your debit card to the actual wallet.
Mm-hmm.
So with the ACH top-up, it's the same time frame that it would be if you were doing a bank transfer to another bank. So I think it happens about 3 times throughout the day. So if you send it in the morning, by that afternoon or so, you would get it. Now with the credit and debit card, linking your credit and debit card to the actual wallet itself, that's instant. So you can pull money from your debit or credit card and pull it right into your wallet. There is ACH top-ups are free, but the wallet providers do charge a small fee for the transfer from the debit or credit card within the actual wallet.
Okay. All right. This texter here says there are no benefits of using SoundDollar over just using Simple Cash or even one of the wallet providers.
I would definitely disagree with that.
Mm-hmm.
You've already mentioned the benefits.
It's
like, because I promise you, if somebody steals your money, it steals your SoundDollar.
Cash.
Because it's digital, you will be able to trace who stole it. So that's going to be an incentive. That's going to dissuade people from stealing money from individuals.
You can drop your cash. You can
fall out your pocket.
You could lose your cash. You could lose your phone, but you don't ever lose the SoundDollars that's on your phone.
Right.
Definitely so many business and just even the convenience of and the safety aspect with credit and debit cards. And again, it's not a replacement. It's an alternative. It's great when you have instances where you can't get cash. If you go in, there's a group, Nodes Knows, on Facebook, type in ATM. You will see the litany of complaints of people saying, I've been driving up and down
trying to find one that works.
No, you can't go for money whenever people just get paid. They don't put enough money in.
Right. And so,
I mean, the scenario that I think of is if you need a tow truck and you don't have the cash on you, and of course he's not going to have a card machine. If you both have SoundDollar wallets, you can easily make this, right?
Yeah. Right.
Or in the middle of the night, the plumber has to come. It's 1 a.m. You don't want to have to leave the house for him to follow you to the ATM. No, if you could just.
I'm not going to the ATM if it's dark.
Right. Exactly. This will be the time. So that he's come, the electrician or the plumber has come in the middle of the night and fixed whatever the problem is, transfer this.
I could see the ATM from my house, and I'm not going.
Those are the perfect times when this would work.
Yeah.
You don't have the cash, and he's not going to accept credit cards.
Yeah. I mean, everybody from even the water delivery, I'm trying to get so just actually talking to the guy who delivers the water through our neighborhood, because sometimes I don't have cash, and I'm like, I really need 2 bottles.
Yeah, right.
You know, the other day when there was that shortage of water, I was like, I really need 2 bottles, but I don't have no cash. You don't accept SoundDollar, you know? Yep, and so...
Yep.
So that there's lots of benefits. And then don't forget, really the genesis of this is
Family
Islands and the challenge. We are so privileged here in New Providence, and just what these the business owners and people have to go through. They have to take a flight to Nassau just to make a deposit.
Oh, wow.
People are fighting over the last $50 in the ATM machine, big fight breaking out, you know, at the ATM.
Oh, that's really happening.
So, yes, yes, absolutely.
Because you need the money, because how else will you be able to buy? We live in a society where we don't barter for things. So it's like, I produced the labor, my labor is produced, but I cannot get the value for my production.
Yeah.
Now, you were saying that there are two other tiers, right? I imagine that one tier is specifically for businesses similar to
So the tier one, basic tier,
$500.
Right. Tier two holds up to $8,000 at any given time.
Right.
Now, that does require some KYC documents. That does require you to upload your some kind of government issued ID.
And that's like for small businesses, I imagine.
No, that's for anybody.
I mean,
but small businesses. So so I'll get back to that. So the tier three,
okay,
which is the merchant wallet, that holds up to $1 million. And so you do have a lot of businesses, small businesses, who can get by with just the tier two. So the tier one and the tier two, there are no fees. So transaction, and coming also from me personally, I grew up in retail. And so we had a lot of business on the family islands. And I can, you know, I just think about how this would have been so useful with those sales and inter-island trade, because right, that's always the big holdup, right? You know, waiting on that payment to come through, especially if the person doesn't have the, you know, the same bank. And so, but most businesses can get by with the small businesses can get by with just the tier two.
Right, especially if you have it linked to your business account.
Yes, and that's with the tier two. So the tier one can't be linked to a bank account because there's no KYC, but the tier two can be linked to a bank account.
All right, so how many places are accepting Sand Dollar now?
So right now...
All of the large grocery stores.
And that's one of the main reasons why I'm here today is to talk about a really exciting program and promotion that we have going on. But
I have notes on that as well. I'll tell you offline.
Okay. So over 1,600. And so it is a challenge. You have, again, that chicken and the egg situation that we always talk about, where the merchant is saying, okay, well, I don't see any, you know, I don't see any consumers coming in, or
the chicken came first.
Yeah. And the consumers, that's the first question they ask. Where can I go and spend this? And
it's not just jollification money. It's not just...
No, this is real currency. And the thing about it, this isn't anything new. Like, abroad, we're behind, you know, we're really, you know, we're behind people abroad in the States. People are using Cash App, you know, send it to my Cash App,
Apple Pay.
You know, Apple Pay, digital wallets. It's nothing new.
Right.
And so millions of people use digital wallets.
See, and I feel like it will catch on when you have enough persons in the system. Now, somebody inside this room has once recommended that the government needs to pay
workers with it. Until the government does this, we're really not going to see it take off.
The biggest employer inside the country. If the government says, hey, we are going to be paying you with Sand Dollar, everybody has a Sand Dollar wallet, right?
Mm-hmm.
You will suddenly see everybody have it. And now the business owners aren't going to say, well, I don't see nobody coming in. Because people will be coming in and saying, hey, I have Sand Dollar. I would like to buy groceries. You guys need to get your kiosk up. You need to get this running.
Yeah.
Maybe not your regular paycheck, but I mean if you have a one-off or contract or something.
No, or even like overtime, or like we pay certain things inside Sand Dollar.
Yeah, so conversations are happening. And so we do anticipate some things in the future.
Your whole paycheck.
Yeah.
You do, but I do want to. I want to go back to those grocery stores, because I really do want to talk about the promotion that we have going on. Mm-hmm. So right now, you can save when you go to Super Value. They're participating. Super Value, Solomon's. So any of the Solomon's locations, and this includes Solomon's in Nassau and in Freeport, not Exuma Markets, but Solomon's in Nassau and in Freeport, and as well as the Fresh Market stores, and then also Sawyer's Fresh Market, which is located in Freeport. They have two locations. So when you spend $50 or more in sand dollars at any of those locations, you can get up to $25 back. What we have is an online rebate. So just take a photo of your receipt, a screenshot or a photo of the transaction, the sand dollar transaction in your wallet of that particular purchase, upload it to the form at sanddollar.bs/rebate, quick little form. Submit that, and then you can get, so anything, so it's a minimum of $50, anything under $100, you're going to get back $10, and then $100 or more, you get back $25. And it is, so this, the whole objective is where we have a campaign that we're going to be running, which is really educating the public on how to top up, and because what we did starting from June to the end of August, we had a number of pop-up events at these stores. Mm-hmm. And what the primary objective with that was getting people to download wallets and getting people to really experience using it in the store. So now we're saying, okay, you have your wallet, you've experienced, you understand how to make that purchase at the register. Go on out, top up your wallet on your own, spend $50 or more. Upload your receipt and the photo or screenshot of your transaction to the rebate form online at sanddollar.bs/rebate, and we'll give you back up to $25. Mm-hmm. So again, under $100, you get back $10. $100 or more, you get back $25.
That started already?
That starts today.
It starts today.
So the form is up, and mm-hmm. it is live. So if you're going grocery shopping this weekend, load up your sand dollars. And ordinarily, people say, well, for those who are credit and debit card users, if you ordinarily use, your credit or debit card, again, this is really an educational experience for you to experience topping up, mm-hmm. for you to then, also experience and learn how to use it at the registers. But definitely for those who are cash heavy users and walking in, you could load up your cash on your phone. And then just take your phone with you to the store as well.
How long is it going on for?
So it's until October 15th.
Okay.
Yeah, until October 15th. Mm-hmm. This whole month is all about educating on how to top up. And so we have that. And then we also have, at the end of the month, the mall has its, I believe it's celebrating 34 years, its anniversary weekend. We're going to be there in the center court of the mall on September 29th and September 30th. So we're saying, show us that you've topped up. Again, we want people to learn and get familiar with topping up. Show us that you've topped up within the last 30 days. Mm-hmm. Bring your wallet. Show us the transaction in your transaction history that you've topped up. Look, I topped up on the 19th or whenever. And we'll give you $20, an additional $20 top up. We also have a rebate. Where when you spend $10 or more at a participating mall merchant, so we're compiling and finalizing that list. When you spend $10 or more in sand dollars with a participating mall merchant, you can come back to our table in the center court and get $10 back on your purchase.
Mm-hmm. Wow. All right. We've got some calls coming in, a lot of text messages, and you can call in as well if you have any questions for Shandira Newton.
Shandra
Newton. Give us a call. 323-6232. 325-4316. 325-4259. Call us toll free. 242-300-5720. Tweet us, Facebook us, text us. 422-4796. Okay, let's take this call. Good morning, caller. You're on the air. Hi, good morning. You're on the air. All right, let's take this one. Good morning. You're on the air.
Hello.
Hi, good morning.
Yes, good morning. Yeah, I agree with the digital currency and the $5 and all the digital ways to pay. And also, given incentive, web may get more people to jump on board. The only thing I have a challenge with is taking options away, like taking the option to pay with cash. Because I've been to the airport recently, and I had to go pick up somebody, and I had to park my car, and you can't pay with cash at all. And I think with the addition with digital currency, or another, it should be another way to pay, not taking away cash or whatever. I think, and that's the only challenge I have with it. Certain places you go, you can't use cash. And that's my challenge for the whole digital era. I mean, it should be an added option and not taken away options that you already have.
Okay.
Can I respond?
Thanks a lot. Yes, please.
Yeah, so, well, definitely that is a decision on the business's part. Again, we're not advocating for, you know, the removal of cash. Here, we do recognize, a lot of people don't recognize, and businesses do, and that's why so many are trying to reduce their cash footprint, that cash has a... Okay.
Could I say one more thing?
Mm-hmm.
With everything, if you deal with computers or technology, it's not if it's going to crash, it's when it's going to crash.
Right.
So, I mean, you should have a redundancy when it comes to anything, especially when it comes to digital currency and all these things. We deal in electronics and bits and O's and bytes or whatever. I'm only saying you shouldn't have, not saying that you're proponents of this, but you shouldn't abandon, you know, the old way of, not saying that you are, but I'm saying you shouldn't, like how some companies are doing.
Yeah.
For the new technology, because it's not if it's going to crash, it's when. And in the Bahamas, we don't have like a lot of redundancy when it comes to technology. That's the only part I'm going to say.
I'm going to just say, like, we have to have redundancy as is, because most of our money is just an idea on somebody's computer. Because, like, I know I don't have my money inside my pocket or under a mattress. It's in a bank somewhere on a computer.
Right.
Yeah, so the redundancy already exists.
And that's why we will continue to issue cash. But again, I started to talk about why some businesses are trying to reduce their cash footprint. You know, there's that we in business, you sort of think about those really obvious costs, like the cost of salaries, the cost of electricity, the cost of paying rent. Mm-hmm. But cash carries a cost. There's the cost of counterfeit bills. Just the other day, I forget which island it was. They had a series of counterfeit bills coming through, and that's a loss to the business owner, the cost of security, securing that cash, the cost that results due to theft, employee theft, armed robberies. Think of the gas stations.
So the central bank is not discouraging companies from going cashless? Or can you do anything about that if they're entirely cashless?
I can't speak to that. Mm-hmm. I really can't speak to that, but like we do recognize.
The Minister of National Security, I felt like he said something like, that's not a real thing. I could be.
What's not a real thing?
Like, cashless is not a real.
Does it matter what he says?
No, but
it's becoming a challenge for a lot of people.
Right.
And that's one of the reasons why.
Yeah.
That's one, and that's a segment that Sand Dollar also was created for. Again, that's a solution for these business places. You go right now, for example, Mother's Day. If you want to go and have dinner over at Atlantis. Yeah. You can't go in there with cash, with Sand Dollar and having it on your phone, those businesses who do want to reduce their cash footprint, they can still transact in the with those consumers.
All right, so you mentioned Atlantis. So we know that a lot of the valet services, sometimes it's all you can do. They don't accept cash anymore.
Because they don't trust employees.
Do they accept Sand Dollar?
Valet where?
At any of the major resorts.
I am not familiar, but I do know it is something that we would actively like to see.
Mm-hmm.
So the Sand Dollar Adoption Unit is a fairly new unit. In fact, we just added some new members to the team. And so I think you'll definitely start seeing more outreach now that we have the full complement of staff. But we definitely need more merchants coming on board, and we're going to be increasing that outreach to merchants as well.
He mentioned the airport. Do you know if they accepted?
Are supposed to.
Sand Dollar. Mm-hmm. We hope to in the very near future.
All right. Listen, once again, to go back to Dwight's point, right?
Mm-hmm.
There are places and institutions that are affiliated with the government that have not adopted yet. And they should be the first ones on this, all right? Because if I'm going to pay my electricity bill, if I'm going to add minutes to my phone on your website, I should be able to use Sand Dollar.
Mm-hmm.
Some of them have the icon, it don't work. Some of them don't have it. But I'm just saying, like, it should not be a question of if, because you are a part of the government. This is a government initiative. Mm-hmm. I'm just saying, central bank, is are you guys not?
I can't speak to that.
You understand. But, my whole point is that, like, I feel like the government.
It is something that we're definitely advocating for, and we are having those conversations.
I should be able to pay road traffic with it. I should be able to do everything with it.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Let's take these calls really quickly. Good morning, caller. You're on the air.
Hey, good morning again, Dwight. Good morning, Stephen.
Good morning.
I have a challenge for Stephen.
Okay.
He seems to really like the idea of bartering. Why don't you start something like that? It's a challenge. Start something like that. I don't know if you can do it on
Facebook. Why would I go backwards? The reason why money was invented was because there are going to be times where if I make shoes, somebody's like, I already have shoes. I don't want shoes. I want something else. So it's like, for ease of business, that's why money was invented. So it's like, we all could agree that my shoes are worth $30.
Right, because we all agree with the talent that Steven has. We all come to an agreement that nobody's what he has to offer is worth $250.
Scream at me for this bag of chips.
I want my money back.
Yeah. Right. And also, that's the reason why we have money.
Let's take this call, please. Good morning. You're on the air. Hi, good morning. Turn on the radio for us, please.
Yes, good morning, Dwight. How are you?
Doing well.
All right, good morning to Stephen and good morning to you again.
Good morning.
The last few minutes of it, but I hear the thing about the sand dollar. Mm. One of my concerns has always been, while I am always supporting of technology and the advancement and so forth, I think there's still one thing in regards to all of these digital currencies that we are forgetting, and that is, according to our law, the payment of any bills by cash is still the law. And it seems as though, I don't know, but it seems as though a lot of companies are looking like they're trying to bypass that. Again, notwithstanding the improvements and the technology and the advancement, we still have a lot of people, poor people in particular, and those who may not be able to have these cards or afford these things, may not be able to do so. Can your guests speak to that? Or can you all speak to that about the use of cash as regards to the legality of it and in comparison to the sand dollar and all of these digital currencies? Thank you, Alex.
I had a question I wanted to ask.
You're still there, right, Carl?
I'm still here.
You said they're not able to afford these things. Could you specify what you mean?
It's a general statement that, as you see over the last few years, a lot of companies have been putting a lot of things forward for, you know, to get credit cards or debit cards or these things, and there are still some people out there who do not have these things or not able to get these things.
And those are the people that need
sand dollar.
That's exactly the point. Let's let
Shiandra
explain that again. All right. So for those people who are unbanked,
are not able to get a bank account, and this is really great too.
And also not to lose money to random fees at the bank.
Yeah.
Because it's like, if you have less than a certain amount of money, you are going to lose money every month from the bank having your money, as opposed to gain interest.
Mm-hmm.
And so it's, with sand dollar, you could circumvent that.
Yeah.
So to speak.
And this is also a way, even for micro-sized businesses who maybe want to get a loan. Right. Think about, you know, maybe they want to get a loan. This is a way for them to be able to show their transactions. And look, I'm doing this amount.
I make money.
Because if it's just a cash business, you know, you get that cash and then you go and you pay this bill and you pay that bill and you don't really kind of see, you know.
But you have a digital record.
But you have a digital record of those transactions.
I mean, so it's just getting ridiculous now, right? So the excuses are getting ridiculous. So what if you can't afford a smartphone? What if you? That's a good question. We'll get to that in a bit. But they also go on to say, what if I can't afford data and Wi-Fi? What if I can't afford electricity to charge a phone? What if I can't afford electricity to charge? So come on now. Then obviously you aren't living. So stop it. Listen to what Shandra's saying.
But I want to say this.
But the smartphone thing is a good question. What if you don't have a smartphone? How does this work?
Um, it, it really does require a mobile phone, and it doesn't need to be an iPhone. It could be the least expensive. If you could WhatsApp, if your phone could text us this morning, WhatsApp a message, your phone could hold sand dollars.
If you could install an app on your phone, then it counts, whatever. I vaguely remember.
I do know that some of the wallet providers do have a card solution that can be linked to a digital wallet.
Right.
So you can give the person the card, and then those funds are on that wallet, and then they can use that and spend it like a card.
Right. Mm-hmm. Okay. And then because it's basically going by QR codes.
Yeah, right? Just scanning.
And then depending if, because I know Sandcash even has a face option where it's like, you don't even have to have your phone with you. You could access it once you know what your funds are on the card.
All right, this is a good question. Now, we've heard this before, though. How do you get the funds on the Sand Dollar account if you don't have a bank account? So let's say you were paid in cash, you want to put it on a Sand Dollar account.
Yeah. So two ways. Many of the wallet providers have physical branches. So you can walk into any of their branches and say, I want to top up my wallet, and give them the cash, and they'll put that on your digital wallet. Many of the wallet providers also have a network of kiosks that are at, if you go to the Esso gas station, pharmacies. I've been seeing them everywhere, and they're also spreading throughout the family islands. So definitely just go to your wallet provider's website, and they should have their list of locations as well.
Right.
Oh, and then one last thing, too. Some wallet providers also have agents. So, for example, Super Value is a Canoe agent. So you could go to Super Value right there at the cash register and say, hey, I want to top up my wallet. And give them the cash, and they'll load those funds on.
Okay. This person says here, can you speak a little on privacy concerns surrounding government-issued digital dollars globally? Some activists have raised concerns about government's ability to track their citizens' every transaction.
No, we cannot. Central bank, the same way with your commercial bank, where your commercial bank has sight, we don't have sight of your transactions on your Scotia, Commonwealth Bank, First Caribbean. We don't have sight in what's happening in your digital wallets. Mm-hmm. And trust me, even with the rebate program that we're running, it would have made it easier, but we don't. We cannot see those transactions. Only your wallet provider, who's again like your commercial bank,
if
you have an issue and you can call up and they, what's that transaction number, and you could inquire with your wallet provider. But central bank does not see those transactions.
Right. And then, but also the thing that you're afraid of is actually the thing that can help you, because although central bank is not the one looking at it, it does help when you talk about digital currency and any sort of currency, that you could go to your wallet provider or you could go to your phone and look and say, well, where's the money going?
Mm-hmm.
Right? And where did I spend this, or I had this amount of money? And being able to track that through your wallet provider or your commercial bank.
All right. So this is
an epistle.
Brace yourself.
Oh, my goodness.
This is wild stuff here. I think
they spent a whole dollar.
They spent $25 on this. Okay, so I'm going to edit because it's too long, but it says, tell the central bank rep that we don't like how the government and the central bank is using taxpayer money to bribe people to use Sand Dollar. My goodness. That same money that Guardian Radio is using in their small competitions on a specific radio show can be used by the government to fix the potholes on the roads instead of trying to bribe people to use central bank Sand Dollars. Stop your communist policies, Dwight and Stephen. The government will use Sand Dollars to make sure it is easier to take money from your wallet to pay your BEC bill or water bill or real property taxes instead of using the money to go on vacation. The government this year started to take money from banks to pay people's outstanding real property taxes.
That sounds like a good thing. I don't know.
A precedent has been set for the government spending intake to take your money by force. If you have cash,
You can decide if you pay your BC bill in full this month or go buy some food, etc. We're not interested in this.
I want to speak to that whole
half of the text.
Bribery. Yeah, I see that bribery. So this is an investment in education.
It's for the family.
This is an investment in terms of like the rebate. He's referring to the rebate program. Mm-hmm. This is, we are educating the public. This is an investment in training and education. And so this is just during the initial stages. Any product, for example, that you are looking to use, they would normally give you like a little trial period, right, so that you can experience it, you can use it, you can see if this works for you and how it works for you. And so that's what we're doing right now. We are investing in public education.
Yeah, but I mean, also that person clearly does not like the idea of it at all.
And again, you know, this is, no one is forcing anyone no one is forcing anyone to use the sand dollar. It's an alternative. It's just simply another way to pay. And it's particularly beneficial for those who are challenged in accessing cash, and those who are inconvenienced like me, who does not want to, you know, run out and go to the ATM machine when I'm at home and someone comes to my house and I need to pay them,
right,
you know, or if I'm in a place where I've been in places where even think of fraud with your debit and credit card. Yeah. You know, you've been sort of like shady places where you don't know, I don't know if I want to use my debit, my debit card here.
Yes.
Sometimes,
yes.
You'll see transactions in El Paso, Texas. I've never been to El Paso, Texas.
Or you
know
what that made the show up on your list. Of
right. Messages. And so if I'm not comfortable using my debit or credit card at a particular place.
I know about, because there are certain restaurants.
Yeah, certain restaurants you go. In fact, the other day, I had a flat tire, and I went to this tire shop off the road, and surprisingly, they had a debit credit card machine, because I was so surprised, but I was like, I was so uncomfortable. Yeah, I'm sorry.
I see how y'all go.
I'm so sorry.
You want the people to accept cards, but they're like, oh, but not you.
I wasn't comfortable.
Any place that doesn't have a price listing on their wall, I'm not going to trust you with my debit card.
Okay.
You know,
No. I understand.
Right. So with Sand Dollar, it's safe. You're comfortable and your money is on your phone. You're not exposing your card information. So it's just another way to pay the same way.
Mm-hmm. We're running out of time. Just some two good questions here. I want you to answer really quickly. And then I want you to remind people what's happening, what the promotions are doing.
Yes.
But this person says here, if there is a dispute with a transaction, if you all don't track it, what will happen? How do I get that money back?
So again, the same way. Think of the wallet provider as the commercial bank that you have your bank account with. Mm-hmm. You have your digital wallet with a wallet provider. And so any issues, any disputes or anything, contact your wallet provider.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And this person's asking, if I am a business and I want to accept Sand Dollar, what do I need to do? How do I sign up for this?
Again, there are 7 wallet providers you can choose from. Visit their websites.
If you're a company? If you're a company and you want to be able to accept.
So the wallet providers, they provide wallets for consumers, those tier 1 and tier 2, as well as they provide the tier 3 wallet for the merchants. And so check out their websites, visit their website, look at the features, inquire the same way that you would go to a bank if you're, you know, looking for merchant services. You would find out what their fees are and that sort of thing.
Even if persons are skeptical or like, I don't want to use this or whatever, having the ability to accept money, I do not see why you would fight against that. Just get the wallet so that when somebody comes to you and says, hey, I have Sand Dollar, can I use it here? So you can at least accept it, because you're turning away money now.
I went to a fast food place. I was inside.
George's Chicken?
No.
Because George's Chicken.
I was inside. And they announce, the credit card machine is down, cash only, everybody. At least about 4 or 5 people walked out.
Yep.
walked off the line.
You
so
you saw me there. Yeah. Every week that's happening around here, and mm-hmm. it's mainly because of our wonderful power company, but that's another show. Okay, so really quickly, remind people what's happening.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And the rebate programs. So, yes. So, Super Value, Solomon's, Fresh Market, Sawyer's Fresh Market. Spend $50 or more in any of those stores, and you can get back up to $25. Just take a photo of your receipt, take a photo or a screenshot of that particular transaction, upload it to on the rebate form. It's sanddollar.bs/rebate. And then once you receive that, we'll issue you your rebate. Again, anything under $100 is $10 back. Anything over $100 is $25 back. And this is all part of the education for you to experience topping up and for you to experience, you know, using it at the registers.
Wonderful.
And the price.
And then we have the event at the end of the month. At the mall at Marathon.
Center Court.
Center Court at the mall. If you are a Sand Dollar enabled digital wallet holder, just show us that you've topped up within the last 30 days. You don't even have to have money on your account. You can just show us you could have already spent it, you know, at the grocery store or wherever. Just show us that you've topped up in the last 30 days, and we'll give you a $20 top up. And then if you spend $10 or more at a participating mall merchant, which we're finalizing that list, we'll publish that soon, you'll get $10 back.
Okay, wonderful stuff. You're going to have to come back because the questions keep coming. And and some of them are actually interesting, but we'll hopefully have you back soon.
Yeah.
It's a great opportunity to teach your children financial responsibility, fiscal responsibility, because they have a wallet, and you could give them the money, and then this is an opportunity as opposed to a problem.
Great stuff, Chandra Newton. Thank you so much for being here with us this morning from the Central Bank of Bahamas, and keep us updated, as we said, on Sand Dollar. Stephen Hanna, thank you for being here this morning. Appreciate it. See you next week. And remember, Morning Blend Business brought to you in part by CFAL, growing wealth for future generations. Pick up today's Guardian Business section for the latest in business news in the country. I'll be back on Monday with more Morning Blend and Morning Blend Business on Guardian Radio 96.9. Have a great weekend, everybody. On the Clock with Aaron Green coming up next. Wake up, it's a new day. Wake up.